Unmute. Go to here. Hello, everybody, and welcome to Bizarro Stormy Keep Mole Decision Discussion. I'm Sam Craven, and I am drinking a dark and stormy with homemade ginger beer.
I'm jealous.
That's you.
I'm Logan, and I'm drinking Left Hand's Death Before Disco Porter.
Ooh, man, good choice.
I had one can of it left from when I bought it a while ago, so yeah.
Good choice. Well, dude, if you can make it to Tin Fin Invitational Denver, stock up on Left Hand shit while you're out here.
Well, see, I can get Left Hand shit easily when I'm here in St. Louis.
Oh, do they distribute there these days?
Yeah. I got this like at the crappy liquor store in freaking Port Byron, Illinois, which is in the middle of goddamn nowhere. So,
oh, you can go over to Left Hand Brewery and just get some growlers for the road.
There we go. Because I'm gonna drive and bring a dog and
yeah,
have some pork steaks probably. So,
also, I'm Josh. I'm drinking Renegade Depravity Imperial Peanut Butter Cups.
And I guess I'm Kai. I'm drinking Modern Times Monster Park.
You guys, I'm a little disappointed that the drink introductions on a Tin Fins cast only took 90 seconds.
Well, that's just a start. I mean,
we're going to be
full cabinet over here
throughout the night.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah. I have a small lineup in my fridge already. So.
In text, all of those introductions had bracket, I'm starting with blank. So.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's I got the rum right here, and when that runs out, I got the jam right here. When that runs out, there's a beer fridge right there. I don't even have to leave the camera.
Two bottles of Lafroy, right over there. They were on sale.
Oh, bastard.
All right, we want to talk about Grizzlebrand and how great he is.
I mean, honestly, I still think he's a piece of shit, but it's hard not to play it.
Oh, and I was thinking we should probably make a pun since we're talking about hands and keeping and mulling. We should probably make like an axe hands joke at some point. So I'm putting that on one of y'all.
That's cool. I mean, this is going to be a very sharp discussion. And
Aaron says we're not even reading chat. Yes, we are. And we're not jerks.
Oh, hey, Aaron.
Hi, Aaron. Aaron has to be in the chat after we tweeted that grave hate is hate speech.
I'm falling on something muting. I mean,
yeah, I mean, I clearly deserve that. All right, let's go to our first hand. Yeah?
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Okay. So we've all seen these before, obviously, otherwise, this would be far less interesting. Our first hand is Lion's Eye Diamond, two polluted deltas, Thoughtseize, Duress, Scalding Tarn, and a Shallow Grave.
Oh, I should probably pull up what I wrote about this shit, huh?
No, it would be way funnier if you did it off the cuff and turned out to say the exact opposite thing.
Right?
Alphabetical order, Josh?
Oh, alphabetical by last name?
J is before K. And L and S.
No, so his.
Nice. Listen, we're here to drink and make Grizzle brands, not one of the fucking alphabet, right?
So this hand, I think, is deceptive. We've got protection. We've got, like, if we draw a Grizzle brand, we can discard a Thoughtseize. It's like if you keep this, you're duressing on turn one and then hoping you're ripping stuff off the top. I ship hands like this back. If Shallowgrave were in Tomb, I think this hand is way, way, way better. But as it is, I don't think it's quite good enough. I could see a case for keeping it, but I ship it. Play or draw. It doesn't really matter to me.
Yeah, I mean, I was kind of in the same boat as Josh. I mean, I think I even said when I like wrote my response that like maybe other people are going to be a little bit more adventurous, but it just seemed like not as bad as some of the other hands that, you know, wound up talking about, but it seemed like a little bit of a trap of like, okay, we're totally just relying on the top of our deck. We have no way to shape what we do. We have no way to dig. It's entirely like, okay, I hope that this duress and Thoughtseize give me enough breathing room to do a thing. So would be more inclined to ship this hand back. I feel like there's six card hands that are going to give me a little bit more flexibility. If we knew what our opponent was on, that may change, you know, what you want to do on the player on the draw. You know, being able to like thought seize against like prison decks and things like that on your turn one is going to be a little bit different, right? But I'm probably shipping this back.
And I guess just to, sorry, one other thing that I didn't really vocalize all that well, the combo piece we have in Shallow Grave is the most redundant one that we have in this deck. Sam didn't post the whole list that we're playing in this case, but, or maybe he did, but I don't think we can see it on the screen or anything right now. But generally we're playing four Shallow Grave and one or two Corpse Dance or Burning Wish into Exhum, things like that. So we've got a lot more reanimation than we do ways to get fatties in the yard. So we're relying on top decking an Entomb or a Grizzlebrand, basically. Magus of the Mind is not what we're looking for out of this. So it's got to be, we're basically looking for one of six cards off the top with no cantrips. So.
And to kind of piggyback on what Josh just said about Magus, if you read through the thread, there's been quite a bit of anecdotal evidence. You know, there's obviously not hard math that we've kind of all gone through about like the numbers, you know, from a storm count standpoint that you're looking for when you're going for Grizzlebrands versus Magus and things like that. So like quite clearly like a Magus off the top and like spinning a Magus for like two, three, you know, things like that is obviously not ideal, but that is something to consider too of like what your potential draws are if you're looking to talk about fatties and how those line up against what you're able to do leading up to getting that fatty into play and doing something with it.
Well, my original thing was going to be to keep, but now y'all are really talking me out of it.
That's why I really liked the scenarios in the article that Logan posted, was just seeing the differences between all of our thought processes. And Chris's as well, who's not on the stream right now.
So this was the only one I actually got around to writing something about because I was really busy playing Roller Coaster Tycoon and watching Parks and Rec. I had really important things to do last night, okay? Here was my reasoning for keeping. The Duress is probably strong turn one on the play. On the draw, I would ship this. The Duress is going to clear the way. You have a Thoughtseize to follow up. You have Grizzlebrand as a live draw and Entomb as a live draw. You can do your LED Shallow Grave shenanigans. So that's why I said keep this, but now you're talking me out of it. So I don't know.
I mean, for me, I said I'd keep it. But because this was something that I published like kind of, you know, online in a public place, it was kind of like a fuck it keep.
I mean, that's the Tin Fin's life.
Exactly. Like there's a lot of these keeps where like, or keeps or moles where like 1/4 or 1/5 of the times I will do the opposite of whatever I normally do just because I don't know, let's roll them dice and see what happens. And so with this one, I mean, you know, we have turn one discard. That's cool. And so I'm probably going like Delta into a Swamp into a Grass here. Is probably what my turn one play is going to be. And I mean, we have live draws in the form of, you know, drawing any fatty. We can draw into, you know, cantrips. We can draw into, you know, all sorts of fun, you know, fun things here. And so in my mind, you know, we have something to do on the first two turns. We have our land drops for the first three. I mean, that's, you know, we have a combo piece. I mean, it's reasonable that we can, you know, draw into something decent when you consider that half our deck is, you know, cantrips and, yeah.
Well, it's not, right? We've only got eight cantrips here, and you're looking for one of six combo pieces, and there's far more fast mana in the deck and lands than there is. So your risk of top decking just more mana into Oblivion is pretty high here.
I mean, that's true. You know, because like even drawing like Burning Wish, I guess, doesn't really do too much.
Exactly. That's the problem with Shallow Grave in hand here, over in Tomb, is like Burning Wish sucks in this hand.
Yeah,
it doesn't do you any good. It can't. We're not running tutors in this list or cantrips to be able to Burning Wish for. So your Burning Wish is just a redundant Shallow Grave, essentially, at that a worse Shallow Grave in that point. So you're kind of hosed.
So this leads me to a thing I've been thinking about for a while. Is there a Burning Wish target that replicates in Tomb?
Buried Alive is as close as you get.
Yeah. Well, that card is fucking sweet, so...
It is sweet.
So just so y'all know, Arclight Phoenixes are in the mail.
Oh, god damn it,
Sam. Oh, yeah, dude. Okay, so, yeah, quick tangent. I've been playing Esper Phoenix on Moto and in paper lately. Thank you, Callum Whitefaces, for that shit. That deck is gas. It is fucking good. It's really fucking good.
You also need it for Middle School Reanimator.
Holy crap, a wild Connor appeared.
Connor?
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Oh my gosh.
This is a beautiful collection of humans here.
And it just got 10
Turns
times more
out we let literally anyone into our chat. By the way, while we're on tangents, I have a Middle School deck now. It plays Opposition. Kai is the only one who gives a fuck because he also has middle school.
Because I'm like the only person down here that was like, hey, middle school, anyone? And people were like, oh, that's a thing? And I'm like, fuck yeah, it is. Jesus.
This is the third most expensive card in my deck.
Hey, lands matter.
Fuck that dumb format.
I mean, I don't totally disagree, but it gave me an excuse to bust out the Psychotogs again. One thing I'm curious about, and I don't want to get too far, Connor, in case you had thoughts on kind of this firsthand too. I'm not to put you on the spot or anything like that, but
sure, yeah.
I know a lot of us, like, we joke about, like, hey, like, we're just fucking having fun. We're making Grizzlebees. We're doing shit. Like, we're having fun. But would any of you change your decision of keeping mulling on the play, on the draw, whatever, if it was a difference of I'm playing, like, this is the hand I draw at FNM versus this is the hand I draw, like, round four at a GP? Like, does that change your decision for anyone? Like, I think those of us that were like, I'm shipping this hand, probably not. Because
that probably depends on the amount of liquor the night before.
Yeah, I mean, I'm looking at this from, like, a competitive winning aspect, not just Same. Fucking it.
Yeah.
So that reminds me of when I played my first ever Reanimator deck, a friend really, like, walked me through a lot of the plays and, like, had me goldfish it and be like, no, you want to sequence this way and that kind of thing. And one of his things was like, you should be shipping all the time. Like, you can turn one Grizzlebrand off of four. So if your seven isn't stellar, you should be shipping it. Which is, I mean, this is a very different deck than Blue-Black Reanimator, but I think that is a good rubric for this type of deck.
Sure, totally, because this deck does mulligan pretty well because there's a lot of redundant pieces, and you can still just kill people turn one off a four-card hand.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah, not just put a Grizzlebrand into play. You can kill people.
Yeah, off four cards, right? I think we probably all only need a four cards playing Tinfin's variants at times to kill somebody. So yeah, this deck is.
I actually killed someone on a mold of four with Bizarro like at an FNM recently, and they were pissed, and it was great.
I turned two off of three, keeping a hand with Grizzlebrand in it, and. I Cabal Therapied my opponent, saw Show and Tell, and go, damn, I should have kept a hand with Grizzlebrand.
What an asshole.
He was not happy. He was
Again,
very
confirmed
happy.
Scumbag.
I've done that play too, where like, do you ever like get weird soul reads where like, this person's on Show and Tell, so I'll keep a shitty hand with a Grizzlebrand in it, just like... off the soul read, and then like you thought sees him, and you see the, like the turn two Show and Tell, and you just like I kind of do this that sucks, and you know, maybe, or it was a lot better with Probe, because like with Probe, like you could like look at it and be like, ah, shit. Whereas with thought sees, if you don't take the Show and Tell, it's kind of suspicious, but. Yeah, I've still gotten people where they're like, ah, yeah, Show and Tell. He got all upset about it. Then you know, you kind of like sit there and stress about it. Then flip the Grizzlebrand and
he showed in Sneak Attack with no follow up too. Passed me when I had three cards in hand and I just fucking killed him.
Bold strategy, Cotton.
All right, any other thoughts on hand number one before we go? Because we do have 10.
Yeah. Have you looked at this hand yet, or the article, or anything?
Is this the same hands that were in the article?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I have seen these then. Yeah. Cool.
Any thoughts on hand number one?
I think I agree with Josh. Actually, I think it's a little bit of a loose keep because I think you mentioned there are only six live draws there to actually win the game. So I think more aggressive mulliganing, as people are have been saying right now. I think I'm on board with that.
See, this is where I wish I had the impetus to do the testing that I did before we ever published a deck list, where I actually sat and replicated games over and over again to figure out what to do.
So, Connor, does that change if you know your opponent's on Bomberman?
God, how good is that hand against Bomberman? I guess you've got the Thoughtseize to turn off any getting killed really fast, but... Ooh. I would mulligan that against Bomberman. I think you're in a better... I think you're better off going really fast there than trying to just randomly disrupt them.
I'm just trying to picture like what our sideboard plan is. Like, oh yeah, Bomberman, I have that in my sideboard guide.
So for those of you on stream and on camera that don't know, Connor is the illustrious Wanderlust on The Source, who's been brewing Imperial Bomberman for years at this point.
It is years now. It's kind of embarrassing, yeah. But yes.
Many years.
The deck is sweet.
Yeah, let's get this out of the way real
cards
quick.
I don't want to pay for.
Yeah.
Oh, I gladly paid for them. Let's get this out of the way. Like years ago, a mutual friend of Josh and mine, Tim, Honey Tea, introduced me to Josh at, I don't even know what event it was. He goes, oh yeah, this is .dk on The Source. I like lost my shit. I'm like, wait, you're .dk. So then fast forward years later, Josh is like, oh yeah, this is Connor. This is Wanderlust. I'm like, wait, what? So yeah. You're watching a star-studded stream. This is great. You've got brilliant people here who like to do crazy shit and sling cardboard. And
I always forget also enjoy Josh Dr. K, and I'm like, who is this asshole thinking he's somebody in a Tinvin thread?
And then Sam realizes he's reading his own post, and
oh, there. Yeah, that. I mean, that. Me and MTG The Source don't get along.
No one gets along with The Source.
Honestly, right. I was reading it a couple days ago, and it's pretty good.
All right, let's go to hand number two.
First time forever.
All right, hand number two is a brainstorm. Is that from Conspiracy? God, who made this? Bloodstainmire, Thoughtseize, Underground Sea, Ponder, Cabal Ritual, Underground Sea.
I mean, first of all, I have those exact same brainstorms, but in like Japanese, so you can, show some respect here. Second, since I'm opening my mouth, I mean, I kind of ship this one because I really dislike hands that are just like cantrips and discard because those are just such trap hands. They look fine and then you just do nothing and then die and then are sad. That's been my experience like all the time. And I don't know what it is, but I just never have luck with these hands. And so my gut instinct is to ship it.
Yeah, if this was like Esper Control, I would totally keep this. But it's not. So what we're going to do here is go like Ponder, Go, Brainstorm, Fetch, Thoughtseize, and like now my dick is in my hand, but I can't perform. Like, yeah, I'm saying the same thing you did, but in a much more vulgar way, I suppose. This hand doesn't do anything.
Hey, okay. I don't know if somebody wants to talk first, but this is
like,
I disagree with you guys, but
I mean, me personally, like I would be most inclined. I would probably ship this back just if I looked at it and was like, oh, I need to find all my combo pieces. At the same time, you have Ponder, you have Brainstorm and a Fetch, like you have Thoughtseize as well for protection. Like this is a hand that if I'm feeling a little bit more conservative that day, I'm going to ship back. But there are a lot of days where I would also keep this because even though it's like, oh, I need to find a lot of stuff to do anything, it has the tools for me to be able to do that stuff and protect myself either once I find those things or along the way, depending on what my opponent does. So like if I go turn one, you know, Underground Ponder, my opponent does, I don't know, whatever sort of like Planes, Aether Vial bullshit, then great. I could Thoughtseize and then also do other things. Or again,
see,
whatever.
That's exactly why I said I would keep this if this was Esper Control, is like everything you draw into is going to be pretty okay. There's a lot of dead draws off this Ponder and Brainstorm though. Like you draw a couple rituals and a Lotus Petal, you're just like, awesome. That does nothing.
Yeah, but okay. So if this were Tin Fins, I would 100% ship this. But this list in particular that we're talking about, turning three Burning Wish,
and empty the warrens as a wish target. So that changes the math here from traditional Tinfin's variants a good bit. So there's actually a good bit of live draws that we can have in this case with Ponder or Brainstorm, or both together, to be able to empty for 8 to 10 on turn 2 or even combo off with that. So I think in this deck, because you've got Ponder, Brainstorm, and a fetch land, and a protection spell, as well as a ritual, I think this is keepable. It's not a hand that I love, but it's got a lot of potential to it. And you could thank you for putting at least part of the deck list up.
Live editing is, and then because I had to put my laptop down because I'm on more than one computer. Yep. Yeah, it's not easy to live edit a stream.
Yeah, totally. So because we've got those alternate lines in this that you don't usually have in Tinfin's proper, I feel like Ponder and Brainstorm here are way more powerful than they are in a traditional Tinfin shell, because you've got the potential of just drawing Burning Wish LED and emptying for 8 or 10, which is, on turn 2, is going to get there against most decks.
I got to tell you, I miss the empty lines all the time.
You don't play enough Storm.
No, I don't. No Josh, one plays enough Storm. Cyrus doesn't play enough Storm.
Yeah, but Josh
Cyrus has missed more the Entomb Shallow Grave lines. Just go straight for empty.
I don't know if Ritual Entomb Shallow Grave. Nope, ship the hand.
I had the last time I played, it was this 75. I had a hand, I was like, I can Burning Wish with 4 floating, and I will be at Storm 4, and then I will cast my spell, and then nothing happens. And as soon as the cards hit my deck, I go, I have emptied the warrens.
Yeah, it's a powerful tech. It gives you a great orthogonal line to the main deck plan of reanimation. So it's like, it's good in sideboard games for protection, as well as just like, you know, the crap out a bunch of goblins game one and sometimes just get there.
Well, because there's to your point about Storm, like there's a reason why a lot of Storm decks, and I primarily play like traditional Storm, like Ant or TES, like why they will sideboard in more Empty the Warrens or just side into Empty the Warrens, depending on which list it is in game twos and stuff like that, depending on the matchup, because there's some decks where they're just not totally cold to it, but they're just like, well, shit. Like there have been, I got by Death and Taxes with a Holy Light exactly twice in all the years that I've played, you know, Storm, right? So, like, there's some decks where, to your point, Josh, it's like, hey, turn two, unless they went, like, the perfect, like, Mom into Stoneforge Mystic for Batterskull, like, that 10 goblins is going to get there. It's a lot of decks, right? Both
things, right? So it's a percentage game, just like what Bryant plays in TES.
Yeah.
Do we need to be thinking about Chalice with this hand? Do we need to assess the meta prevalence? So if we're on, you know, we don't know what our opponent's playing, do we need to be thinking about the percentage chance they're going to turn one Chalice us with this particular?
Yeah.
I mean, I personally don't typically take that into account because I don't feel that Chalice is like, I'm assuming I'm at a GP and I don't feel like Chalice is a big enough part of it.
You're also just like so fucked if they have Chalice with like 95% of hands, you just scoop a Chalice on one, so don't even think about it.
Yeah.
Don't even think about it. Sure. Okay.
In game one, this deck is pretty bad against Chalice. So like if they Chalice on one turn one, you're in a world of hurt anyway. So
plus you don't know like me, all of your Chalice opponents will just miss their triggers repeatedly.
But at the rate we're gonna have to babysit. I think kind of brings up a good point though of like there are gonna be hands where because we have like Cabal Rituals and you know Wishes for Exhumed or Shallow Grave, you know, we have those two CMC things. It's like that's why I hate bringing back these analogies continually, but like TES versus Ant, right? Like a Chalice on one against TES, you're just like, well, good game. I hope I have a Burning Wish into like a Pulverize or something like that and can kill you from there. Whereas Ant is like, sweet, Cabal Ritual, LEDs, Tutor, kill you. Like, you know, there's other alternatives. I think that is a really good question though, with like, does that change, you know, the way you approach it of like, we're talking like Ponder's turn one versus like Thoughtseize turn one or whatever.
Well, if you think that Chalice is a good part of the meta, you could either, if you're on the play, you can either Thoughtseize turn one or Ponder turn one. Either of those are probably okay.
Yeah.
In that case. And then if Chalice is really heavy in your expected meta, I think you just ship this hand.
Yeah.
So it seems like everyone's shipping, which I have a question. Let's say for some reason.
Yep. Oh, everyone's shipping. I'm keeping this hand.
Okay, well, for the rest of us, let's say someone made you keep this hand and you're on the play. Which spell are you playing first?
I play Ponder, no question.
I'm on Ponder.
Yeah, Ponder.
Off of sea, or are you, well, I guess we can't fetch for an island, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah, we definitely want to play it off sea anyway and take the wasteland gambit. At least at the moment, there's not a lot of wasteland around. So you Ponder off sea, and then you have Brainstorm fetch land on the next turn to possibly just kill them.
And you're totally fine losing a sea to a wasteland anyway, because you have another one and a fetch anyhow. So it's right. Not like you're like, well, crap. If they waste this, then I have like
you have more than time walk on them, I guess.
Yeah.
The one thing I'll add on to this is what am I playing first? If I'm playing at my like local game store that I play FNM at, I'm honestly firing off Thoughtseize first. Because my meta has turned very combo-y in recent months, and I've been watching a lot of people play with varying degrees of success Dark Deaths Tinfins deck, so our Ice Station Zebra. And so it's been really funny kind of like, you know, trotting over and birding them and then watching them like sequence Grizzlebrand draws sevens really horribly. And
then they put a 20/20 into play and you're just like, well, I guess that's pretty good.
Yeah, that's pretty good too. I should really pick up Dark Deaths. But, you know, and so like if I'm at a GP and we're playing the, all right, I am forced to keep this hand, then yeah, see Ponder, but like at my local game store, I'm probably playing Thoughtseize like 50% of the time first. Like I feel like it's a coin flip between the two. Just knowing what's in my local meta.
I think that's a really good point though, because it's like the same reason when people are constantly like, oh, you know, do you have a sideboard guide for this, or you know, what's the best sideboard to play? It's like depends. Like, are you trying to do well at a larger event, or is it your local meta? Because I never would ever give someone like a suggested sideboard for their local meta. Like, dude, I don't play at your store. I don't know. I'm bringing like,
well, when I was in Houston, something to be said. Like, this is such a weird deck that if you play this four times in a month and a half at your local, people are going to know how to play against it. They're going to expect you to be on it, and they're going to mull based on you being on it.
Right.
Yeah.
Those questions I just assume are referring to a GP meta. Like
it's
a foolish question otherwise, right?
But I'm just saying to Logan's point of like your play patterns are going to change depending on the situation you're in and all that sort of stuff. If you're sitting around against the guy who's never done anything except Tomb, Chalice, like that, right, that's going to probably change what you do a little bit. But it's a good point is all I'm saying.
I have a guy at my local meta who literally for the last year, he always turn one on the play, blind against me, Cabal Therapy, naming Dark Ritual, and he'll fucking hit like 80% of the goddamn time. And
shit. So stop keeping against that guy.
Yeah, no kidding. I'm just like, oh man, I got this like cool with like Dark Ritual, Entombed Shallow Grave. All right, let's fucking rock and roll. And then he'll blind therapy, name Dark Ritual. I'll be like, well.
Yeah, I have the problem that this deck is terrible in my meta because like you'll show up, there'll be 12 people, two of them will be on Pox, one of them is running main deck Rest in Peace. Everyone knows how the deck works.
That's 80% of the reason I didn't bring this when I came to visit you, Sam. Sorry, Josh, I cut you off.
Oh no, you're fine. I was just saying I stopped playing some paper at locals. Which I did with Tin Fins for like 2 years too, but back in the day. For the same reason. It's just, it gets not fun when you play it over and over again against the same people.
Yeah.
I still jam this shit. I don't care.
Yeah. Well, the first time I ever actually comboed off was the third event that I brought it to. And the guy didn't know how the deck worked. And I had never actually comboed to completion before. So like game one took like 35 minutes.
Everyone's first time is a little awkward, Sam. It's okay.
But boy, is it memorable.
Moving on. Let's go to hand three.
I'm with it.
Yeah. Hand three is two deltas, two brainstorms, a lotus petal, a burning wish, and a shallow grave. This has so many combo cards in it.
Yeah, I like this hand. I think this one's an easy keep for me. And we got two cantrips, we got two lands, we have two business spells. I mean, yeah, they're both redundant. As we mentioned before, where you know, Burning Wish can't necessarily entomb a creature for you. But you know, I feel good with two brainstorms going into it. I can find something to do with either one of those cards. So I like this hand.
So as a green monster, I would keep this and I would go Petal Brainstorm, because there is a chance that Petal Brainstorm just fucking draws the win.
See, my green monster would go Delta Main Phase Brainstorm, just to conserve the petal if I don't happen to hit the three card Monty off the Brainstorm. So,
well, I've just found like a lot of the times, like, I mean, you want to do your perfect Brainstorm very skill intensively, right? Is that like Petal Brainstorm fetch is, like, works out really well a lot of the time that I do it.
So it does, but the problem with this hand though, Sam, is you've got Burning Wish in it, right? So you want to preserve your petal for a possible empty line. Mm-hmm. So your first Brainstorm, you're looking for either an Entomb or a bunch of fast mana. Either is fine, because on turn two, then fast mana and obviously discard, you know, some protection spell or whatever you're looking for, Daze or whatever you're playing. So that way you can Brainstorm into either fast mana, Burning Wish empty, or Brainstorm into Entomb, make a Grizzlebrand kill them.
So the card, I the number of times you have reminded me that the card Empty the Warrens exist is now two.
I think it's important to think about discard as well from our opponent. So keeping a Brainstorm on their turn could be more valuable than trying to go for the knots on turn one here.
Yeah, good point.
Since there are a lot of decks running discard and counter magic right now.
That's a really good point.
Yeah, Grixis Control, that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Grixis Pyromancer as well. It's also seeing a lot of popularity at the moment, so.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm also on the keep for kind of some of the reasons mentioned. I mean, yeah, like in the same way the counter mention of like, hey, you know, discard from the opposite side. Like, to me, that's the only thing that I really would like is a little protection, you know, for this hand. But again, we have cantrips, we have ways to find it, we have, you know, the wish, and we have avenues to multiple lines instead of being just pigeonholed into one thing and you know, like no ways to find it or whatever. So yeah, I like the hand.
Yep.
I wasn't explicit. I would keep the hand.
Well, that was a lot quicker. I wasn't prepared for that to go that quickly.
I mean, I will add one thing. Since we are talking about Empty the Warrens, I do remember a period of time where we kept going back and forth on Empty board because, you know, oh, I don't know if we can cast it reliably or is it actually good enough? And we kept, like, you know, going back and forth on it. And, like, I'm at the point now where I'm like, I don't know how many times I cast it, but there are the games like I just have the empty line and it's just really good. And so yeah,
I would say it's like 15% of games tops, right? It's not common. It's not a common line, but, and when you have it, it's like,
so good.
Yeah, it's really good. And otherwise you're probably just going to sit there either top decking or cantripping trying to find a fucking Entomb or some bullshit like that to,
you know, to me, empty also always feels just like, it feels great. Cause you're just like, what do you have?
Yeah, exactly. Right. Just throw it.
I have 10 goblins. You have two turns.
Right.
And sometimes like, you know, you make eight goblins, you swing for like two turns and then you top deck, you know, you're into Shalgrave. You're like, I guess I'll just like Grizzlebrand with the team. And
yep.
You know. I like it when you swing for like eight, put them to four and tendrils them for six.
Send a message.
Collect the brutality. I'm out. Yeah.
Well, the best thing you can Burning Wish for, in my opinion, is winning more is always the correct line, right? So you grape shot away their board, and then you kill them with Tendrils of Agony.
I do have grape shot in this list.
I'm a terrible person, by the
way. We have grape shot in this list? I didn't even notice.
Hell yeah.
Connor, what were you saying?
I was going to ask what our first fetch land is, what land we get off the first fetch with this hand. Is it Basic Island?
I think I'd get Island with it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so too.
Because we have Petal.
We have Petal and another fetch that gets us any of our other mana sources.
Yeah,
cool. But I think the reason you're asking the question, I can see a lot of people just like defaulting to like fetch, underground sea, blah, 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 and they're like, ah, shit.
Yeah, not thinking about it. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I think for me, it depends on what my opponent does, to be honest, because I'm going fetch, pass turn, brainstorm, end of opponent's turn. And if my opponent is, you know, slinging Dark Rituals as well, then yeah, I'm just going to get Underground Sea so I don't have to think about mana later on. You know, but if there's Wasteland, then yeah, I'm grabbing that island.
I think in the blind, yeah, you want the island just because, like, this hand really, like, it can go off so hard and losing that land would be, you know, bad.
So it looks like Jacob's on the fuck it plan. Just do whatever. Just get Underground Seas. Always. I mean,
Jacob's always on the fuck it plan. So am I. Look, yeah. You go 0-5, you get to drop and go do stuff.
It's a good point.
See, I've long since decided that, like, I'm not good enough to actually, like, grind my way to things. So I just need to be really lucky that day. And so a lot of my keeps in the moment are just based on how I'm feeling in that exact moment.
Like, yeah, that's why you gotta listen to Power by Kanye West before every round.
Yeah, we call that the strategy. You just keep shit and it works out for you. Oh, there's a kitty.
Also, there's a Jacob.
Hey.
Black cat, that's a 1 and a black 1-1, right?
That's right. So many skulls.
All right, Jacob. I will counter your cat with this cat.
Oh, God. That's a big fat white cat.
If the keyboard starts typing random letters, it's because the cat is stating her opinion.
It's not just you being drunk.
She probably turned the keyboard off just in case.
I guess it's only 6:35 California time.
It is only 6:30. Yeah, that natural light there.
I would say the sun is probably still out. It's like 75.
It is 75.
My heater is on 58 and blowing.
All right, I'll be back in a second. I need to go refill my beverage.
So what's the hand we're looking at? I can't quite see it.
Hand number three.
So it is two deltas. Delta, Delta, Brainstorm, Brainstorm, Petal, Burning Wish, Shallowgrave.
Are we critiquing Logan's article here?
Yeah.
I don't think critiquing so much as repeating it out loud live.
Oh, cool.
And also some of us didn't submit things, so we're doing it on the fly.
I feel targeted.
Fuck it, Sam, fuck it, we'll do it live.gif.
Sam, confirm or deny for chat, Garrick's axe in the wall.
That is indeed Garouk's axe. My LGS just had it shipped to them for a promo when they made those like 3 years ago. And I was like, I fucking want that. How much do you want for it? And they're like, I don't know. It wasn't on the invoice. I was like, I'll give you 100 cash. It's like, fucking sold, dude. Turns out they were $35 at Target.
Meanwhile, everything in the case is TCG medium.
That was so some shade that no one else
looking
got.
At this man, yeah, I would keep it. I would go with Sam. Lotus Petal, Brainstorm, see what we have, and then fetch the garbage away.
So I thought about making all these hands.
You just go Lotus Petal, land, and then pass the turn. It doesn't really matter at that point.
Mm-hmm.
You telegraph that you're on Storm, but what are we going to do about it? Play a Savannah, November Runes?
You're going to Thought Seize you or play a Chalice on one or a Thorn or a Thalia or any number of just throw dickings.
And we can still beat that with Lion's Eye Diamond, Grizzlebrand draw. We already have the Shallowgrave, so that's going to get there.
I think if anything, the thing that's going to be interesting is that these are very, like, all of these hands, for the most part, are like, there's a lot of ways to, and I'm not even going to use that phrase. There's a lot of ways to go about, like, utilizing these hands or whatever it is. And it's not that any of them are right or wrong. Like, there are some other decks where it's like, well, clearly that was a suboptimal play. You set yourself up to just, like, lose, you know, two turns down the road. It's like, because of all the things that are in the deck, all the avenues the deck has, you can do a lot of these things, and they all are going to potentially pan out, right? Like, Petal, Brainstorm, fetch it away. Great. That's probably going to work in almost as many situations as, like, land pass, Brainstorm, end of turn, you know, go on from there. So that's also why we like this deck, because you have a bunch of people who are like very mathematical, very intellectual, and like the puzzle. And I think that's pretty much all of us like on the stream. So it's like, this is a great deck to be like, well, there's a lot of things I could do. What are my percentages? What feels like it could be like a good avenue, and even just running math on the fly. So it's a lot of fun.
Every single hand that we've shown thus far, every one of us has spent more time talking about it than like, if you did that at a tournament, you would just be fucking done. So like, That's true. We have the luxury of analyzing far more than we would in real life as practice for real life.
Yeah. And yeah, that's exactly why we do stuff like this, right? To get that, the heuristics in your brain, so you don't have to actually think about it like that.
Yeah. So again, props to Logan for getting this article up and getting us all off our asses to actually do something
productive
in the chat instead of just shit talking all day. So
and I'll also point out, I think with one exception, Logan, all of these are randomly generated. Is that right?
Yeah. So essentially, I put this into, I uploaded the deck list. It was in like the playtesty thing, and I apparently just hit okay, restart until I got a hand that was like worth talking about. So I didn't take the first 10 hands that popped up.
You didn't keep Dark Ritual, Grizzlebrand, Shallowgrave for us to discuss?
Yeah, so I literally my first three hands were some combination of Mana Source, Dark Ritual, Entomb, Shallowgrave, and I'm like, where's the discussion at on this? Like, yeah, and
next.
Well, we have to flavor it by saying, four of that over the last eight hands were turn one kill.
That's fair.
Right. Do I give my opponent a shred of hope?
Out of the last three hands in the article, this one is probably the most keepable just because it has two redraws in Brainstorm. It already has one half of a component with Shallowgrave. The Burning Wish is a little bit of a gotcha. It's basically a free mulligan at this point. So we're already at a six-card usable hand, and we have the two lands, which is just perfect.
I think it's worth noting, if that Shallowgrave was an Entomb, this is a keep and then dance.
Yes. Yeah, totally.
Mm-hmm. I think actually one of the later hands is pretty much this, but the grave isn't Entomb, now that I think about it.
Well, that's now you know my response to that hand.
Yeah. So, spoiler, maybe? I mean, I could scroll down and...
Yeah. Come on, Logan, you're a child of the internet. You should know, spoiler alert comes first.
No, it's way funnier if you do it afterwards. All right, let's go to hand four. Everyone's cool with hand four? Yeah. I had to look at my tabs and be like, this is four, right? All right, moving on to hand four. Oop, I have to select the right window. We have Entomb, Burning Wish, Preordain, Ponder, Lotus Petal, Dark Petition, Underground Sea.
And I think this is the point where I stopped actually commenting and submitting thoughts because I was a trash human being. So, sorry.
Hey, we're all trash human beings. It's okay.
And that's why we're on this stream together.
Yeah. Some of us just have more free time than the rest. So, yeah.
Well, Kai, this is your first time seeing it. So what are your thoughts?
Oh, son of a bitch. Honestly, I like the hand. I mean, it's got Entomb. For whatever reason. Okay, there it is. It's got Entomb, it's got cantrips, it's got tutors effectively. It does definitely play pray our opponent doesn't have wasteland game, but I don't play combo decks to worry about wastelands. I play combo decks to get my opponent dead. So I would probably keep this hand. I think it's got a good mix of things to do. And similar to other hands that we discussed, it's not pigeonholing me into I can only go on the reanimation plan or whatever it is. So I like it, if for nothing other than Entomb, and then I have a lot more live draws off the top.
So I think this hand's pretty fucking great. As I wrote in the thing, we've got redundancy, we've got both combo pieces, although pretty much all we're missing is mana here. So we're disrupted by either, discard or counter magic in particular. We've got Dark Petition and Burning Wish to be able to go find either more reanimation or another Entomb with Dark Petition. So Dark Ritual and or Cabal Ritual is really what we're looking for here. So I think his hand's pretty great.
So on the subject of discard, with only one land, would you play out the Lotus Petal turn one to protect it from discard?
On the play or on the drop? I think on the play, I would just go Underground Sea, Preordain. If I was on the draw in game one, I'd probably play the Lotus Petal. Because at two mana, there's a lot more things that could happen. And having the opportunity to go Entomb as well is a big push, especially if we happen to find a reanimation spell or an extra land on top of the cantrip.
Agreed, and I like that you called out the preordained versus ponder.
Yeah, I mean, preordained is the weaker of the two, and even though it does see less cards, it does you're not committed to drawing three of them all at once. Yep.
See, my question was, or my comment was going to be, you know, I assume that all of us would probably keep this hand. What are you doing with that first turn? And for me, I feel like I'd probably be snapping off the Preordain. Just because I as much as I want to try to find, like, the next combo piece, I really just want to find my next, like, land drop, probably more than anything. Because, you know, with two lands, then I can easily, you know, go into Burning Wish for Exhume and just kind of get that slow reanimation plan. So for me, I feel like just trying to hit my land drops or get a ritual is maybe a bit more important. So that's kind of my gut reaction.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. All this hand needs is mana, ultimately. Which turns out that's most of the deck. So,
yeah, make mana, draw cards, tail set.
Yeah, bingo. Yeah, I don't think I would play the pedal either way, though, personally, on the play or the draw, just because of Burning Wish. I may just be valuing empty too much with this hand with Dark Petition in it, but I tend to hold that back for the possible empty lines. Because, like, you start playing those things out, then you know, you're like Storm 3 when you cast Empty the Warrens, which Empty versus 6 is pretty anemic.
This isn't modern.
Well, if you're Storm 3 when you cast Empty the Warrens, then you will have 8 goblins.
Sure. I was meaning like
I was just like, something's not right there.
Yeah. Well,
Sam being pedantic, what?
See, I feel like for me, Burning Wish into empty, like, that line isn't really much. That's not something that is going to be high on my priority list here, because we have two cantrips, we have Entomb, we have a Dark Petition to work towards. Like, you know, I feel it's highly, I don't know if there's, like, depending on, like, what my opponent does turn one and what my next couple draws are, I feel like empty is just not going to be.
Yep, that's a good point. I suppose one of those cantrips is Brainstorm, it'd be a little different story.
Yeah, I think this hand gets really interesting if, say, the Preordain was a Brainstorm, because then it turns into, okay, do you just pay, you know, Underground Sea? Like, if I had Brainstorm, I might go Underground Sea pedal, pass turn, and just, you know, wait and see what my opponent does if I'm on the play or if I'm on the draw.
So you're again going with the I'm going to turn one perfect Brainstorm, but also I'm going to Entomb.
Well, it's more like just pass. It's passing the turn with two mana up and then Brainstorm plus Entomb up, just depending on what my opponent is going to do.
Wow. That is so different than what I would do.
Because, like, you know, I could easily. It's one of those things where, like, I can easily go, you know, if they end up having, like, discard, I could either hide things with Brainstorm, or I can just fire off Entomb, do things, and then, you know, fire off the Brainstorm to hide whatever other goodies I want to hide there. Maybe, you know, maybe the Ponder.
But, I mean, at the same time, the Brainstorm could turn that into a really good empty hand.
True.
So what we're learning is that Josh wants to cut Tendrils of Agony and play Empty the Warrens instead. It's fine. We'll just play Timely in this deck because can afford that anyway.
No way. No, we'll just cut Tendrils for Goblin Warstrike, man.
All right, you're going to have to tell me. Can you, without Googling it, tell me the Oracle text of the card you just said?
No, I can't tell you the Oracle text. I'll admit that. But
can you tell me what it does?
Yes. So it deals damage to target opponent or player equal to the number of goblins you control.
Well, if we're going to do that, you know what we should definitely play instead is Goblin Bombardment.
Oh, Jesus.
Also, I'm really close to finishing my Goblin Bombardment deck.
Okay, but Goblin Bombardment you can't get with Burning Wish. So,
yeah, bingo.
Yeah, get out of here. And okay, is with Warstrike, isn't it like, I haven't read it recently, but was it originally printed as like target creature or player? It's so now it probably says like any target.
I'm looking it up right now.
I was going to say there are five of us in the Goblin Hit.
Goblin Warstrike deals damage to target player or planeswalker equal to the number of goblins you control.
Cool.
Also, I have signed copies of it, so that's a good reason to play it.
That's also the only reason Josh is willing to play it.
Yeah.
Let's not go down the rabbit hole of bad decks you would play because you own signed cards.
Yeah, let's cut all the Grizzlebrands and play like Goblin Bushwhacker and just, you know, but get them that way.
Who needs Shower, babe?
With Phyrexian Devourer as the worst card I have that's signed that I would play in a deck.
I've actually sleeved up Abandoned Hope.
Was it in the Belcher sideboard?
No, no, not to play, just so that I could have it with me and it'd be legal so I could show it to my opponents with therapy.
Oh, yeah, well, I play Library of Flying and Murgoyf in my sideboard all the time.
I have a friend who likes to play... there it is. He likes to play Ral Zarek in his sideboards because for whatever reason, he just really likes Ral Zarek and he puts it in his sideboard. 14 lands, card land sideboard with Ral Zarek.
One of these days, man. Unfortunately, Jacob left. Jacob actually has a story about affecting the meta because of something like that. There was one of the SCG tournaments that he topped. He couldn't find one of the cards he needed for his sideboard, so he played like a suboptimal version, and then everyone played that for like 3 months.
Yeah, I've heard shit like that too.
It was echoing truth, because this was around the time that I was...
That's right. I remember this.
This is around the time where like, I actually did things with the deck where like he couldn't find Chain of Vapor, played Echoing Truth, and then people were just copying him and playing Echoing Truth. And then I also couldn't find a Chain of Vapor, so I was just playing with Echoing Truth, and it just kept happening.
What you eating, Josh?
Have you had on his hand?
I mean, some shrimp and potatoes.
Oh, nice.
Zoe, maybe.
Yeah, I was hoping to go to the taco truck, but then it turns out that I don't have any cash.
Man, that happened to me in the freaking UK last week where I was sitting in my hotel and I was getting gin drunk and I was like, oh, I can get food anytime I want. And then at 8:45, I go up to the bar, I'm like, hey, can I get food? And like, yeah, the kitchen closed like 15 minutes ago. And I'm like, oh, you've been watching me sitting here drinking for like the last 2 hours. Couldn't have
said, hey, the kitchen closes in 15 minutes. Do you want anything?
Yeah, so I, you know, go outside. There's nothing open because it's a freaking small ass town. I go to the kebab place down the street. They only take cash. I'm like, well, I have Monopoly money. Do you want that? And I was like, no, we don't take US dollars.
You didn't pull the Ron Swanson, like, this is good everywhere.
Yeah. And then I went to the other kebab place, which was just a food truck. And he also did not. He was only pounds only, and it was awful. And instead, I just, as y'all in the Slack knew, went back to the hotel and just doubled down on getting drunk. And
yeah, gin is a perfectly acceptable dinner, especially if you're in the UK.
Yeah, there's fruit in it. It's cool.
Which reminds me, with your travel, Logan, if any of you or anyone ever watching the stream knows where the hell to play Legacy in Indianapolis, please tell me, because I'm there all the time for work.
Wait, is there not? I thought was a huge Legacy scene in Indy.
Well, there probably is, but I don't know where it is, so I need somebody to tell me.
There's a thread on the source that's called, like, Where to Play Legacy, and it's just, like, people posting game stores that frequently fire Legacy.
Is that... Okay, I assume that wasn't up to date, because I think one of the last posts is me in there from, like, 3 years ago.
Well, I mean, a lot of it is just like, oh, this place does it now, and, like, why would you post that again? But it would be worth checking out.
Okay, fair point.
You can also... this is in the comprehensive rules. You can use the Wizards event search.
Dude, that thing is a piece of fucking trash.
But a lot of people do schedule their sanctioned events, so you may be able to find it that way.
All right.
And it'll take you 5 minutes, and you could do it while you're on the clock at work.
I did this when I was in the UK to see if there was any places near where I was staying that like did magic, and the answer was no, there fucking wasn't, without me hopping on a train for like 15 minutes.
But you were right next to Hogwarts. There were lots of places that did magic.
Hogwarts is in London. There. I've said it. Hogwarts is in London.
It's surrounded by wilderness. How the fuck is that possible?
Let's all revel in the fact, first of all, that Sam just plugged using not only the source, but also Wizards' own website to find any relevant or important information. So
later,
let's start with
that. About my standard deck.
This is fake, Sam.
I'm still drinking. I poured another drink off screen.
Yeah, the real Sam would be in here complaining the entire time about everything magic related. Like,
no, I'm
Why are you complaining about me not
trying to not do that?
Okay, let's go to the next hand.
Yeah, next agreed. Hand. What?
Yeah.
What am I, like the fucking director here?
Yeah.
All right, we have a lotus petal, a ponder, a polluted delta, an underground sea, a dark ritual with the wrong art, a thought seize, and a shallow grave.
Okay, I'll bite.
Proceed.
This hand's gas. This hand is good. It's almost as good as a hand with this deck gets. We've got half the combo, fast mana, protection. The only way this hand gets better is if we have the other half of the combo that's more, that's less redundant.
We have Entomb.
Yeah, if Shallowgrave were Entomb, this would be better.
We have,
I mean, obviously, with Ponder with Entomb, but
with Thoughtseize, our live draws are 4 Entomb, 2 Grizzlebrand.
Yeah, off of Ponder.
And we have a Ponder.
This
hand actually, Magus of the Mind would not be terrible to draw either.
Yeah, I think Magus is fine here too. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Totally. Yeah. Like this hand is about as good as it gets.
Yep.
Can you tell us about the
what are the Warrant
line in this hand, please, Josh?
Tell you what?
About the MP the Warrant line that this hand has?
Yeah. So, okay, here's the deal. If you Ponder into Brainstorm, play both Brainstorm after you crack your fetch. I don't know, some bullshit like that.
Hey man, you can be on the draw Burning Wish and then just, you know,
win the game.
Yeah. You just go land Dark Ritual, Thoughtseize, Petal, and then be one mana short, I think, because I don't know.
The one thing I was kind of disappointed with all these hands was that there wasn't any good obvious like Entomb for Pass and Flames natural storm lines out of them. But
yeah.
Those are fun with this deck.
Entombing Pass and Flames is just, that might be the highest value play this deck can make.
I tried really hard to find one, and like I think the closest I got was that one a bit down there, like Pass and Flames in it. Just because, like,
yeah,
I don't know. I was doing this at work, just trying to get something together.
Allegedly doing this at work.
I was doing this
on your break while physically at work.
Yeah, I was physically at work, but I was taking my, required 15-minute break per 4 hours of work or whatever it is. But yeah, those things are a lot harder to simulate. The natural,
the problem with this hand is that it's just such an obvious keep, so there's not really that much discussion other than what's it going to do, and the answer to that is like, well, what does Ponder find?
Right, yeah, bingo. I mean, we get 4 looks at a 6 outer out of this, 5.
If you so can, we said
turns draw step, so
I would actually be tempted to fetch here just to.
Hand 9 has the double Entomb, go for Pith hand, so
true, yeah, that's fair, that's fair, you could do that. But that's like go for, we'll get there, but that's like go for Pith and a reanimate. I just mean like the natural storm ritual Pass and Flames lines in the temples.
Gotcha.
So we said we have 6 live draws, like 6 kill you now draws, right?
6 kill you now draws. Actually 7, including Magus.
We have 7 kill you now draws, and we have 53 cards remaining in the deck. And if we fetch, we have 52 cards remaining in the deck.
Yep.
These are all accurate numbers.
I'd be really tempted to like fetch Lotus Petal Ponder.
Oh, to play around days?
No, to cast Ponder off Lotus Petal and then have an underground sea to cast your Dark Ritual.
Oh, I see.
Mm.
Wait,
I mean, why wouldn't you just
it is now clear I am the greediest person in this group.
Wait, I mean, at that point,
Sam's trying to just BDE out here.
I mean, at that point, I don't think you gain like what, 2 whole percentage points by
like,
fetching.
Okay, so people always say like fetching doesn't matter, it's only 1%. Like 1% matters. 1% is not 0.
Well, that's a little different in combo decks, right? Because like you're looking for a card. Something like, I don't know, a fair deck, goblins or whatever, where you fetch land, crack a fetch to go get a card out of your deck. To try to not draw a goblin the next turn or whatever, or to draw a goblin with slightly more percentage. That's worse because your life total matters a whole lot more when you're playing a fair deck.
I will say I have a 100% rate of being like, okay, cool, I'm playing this deck. I am on a 1 outer. I am going to fetch to very slightly reduce the chances, and I do the thing that you never do, and I look at the top card, and it's the card I need.
Yeah, never look at the top card.
No. There's only sadness there.
Yeah, ever. Yeah, never do that.
And on the flip side of all this, you know, results-oriented anecdotal evidence, I mean, if you want to talk to my Land's Edge opponent about thinning their deck and then still continuing to draw the lands that they couldn't fetch out with land tax and then fucking dying about those percentages, I mean...
Yes, I will talk to anyone who wants to talk about their land tax deck.
If you want to thin your deck out of lands, play goddamn Mana Severance.
Yeah.
Okay, no. I did just pull the old hypergeometric calculator, and it's literally not even a full percentage point by fetching one extra card out of it. So
you're going to drop that in the Twitch chat so I don't have to learn how to do that math myself.
I was about to say, this is one of the only streams any of you will ever watch where someone in the moment is like, well, based on this discussion, I've actually pulled up the hypergeometric calculator and...
No, Sean has done the math live on a podcast before.
That doesn't surprise me at all, actually.
Yeah, Seth on MTG Goldfish does that on whenever he does really bad luck because, you know...
Yeah, but he's literally being paid to do it.
Yeah, good for him. Props for him to do for doing that.
Yeah, I mean, I'd cast that Ponder off of Underground Sea always in case you Ponder into a Brainstorm. Then the fetch gets so much better there.
Yeah. Yep.
And also, I'm really stingy with my Lotus Petals because they're just so important for when you're drawing with Grizzlebrand. I don't want to just burn them willy-nilly, you know?
Or activating Magus, Connor said, right? Why Magus is good if you get that off of Ponder with this hand.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, talking about Magus again, one of you ran numbers, right, saying that Magus for 5 or more is very, very likely to win.
7 or more is almost always better than Grizzlebrand.
So,
right, Chris 7 Fields. Or more. 5 or more is still fine, right?
So Chris Fields, who's Manatee on the Discord, he posted an article a couple months ago, I think, with some Magus numbers at low Magus activation counts. It was really surprising, at least in the list that he was running those numbers with, that Magus for 4 or 5 was surprisingly really, really good.
It's worth noting those numbers are they're pseudo anecdotal because how I generated mine was play a hand when it comes time to pick a creature, screenshot, pick Grizzlebrand, then go back and do the same thing again with Magus. It's you might flip the wrong thing the second time that you try that.
Yeah, so Chris used a hypergeometric calculator to go do his stuff, right?
Well,
for the Magus activations, which was it was really enlightening, at least with his list. That I didn't think Magus for 4 was that powerful, but honestly, it's really good, and Magus for 5 is really, really good.
On the last hand on this, I actually did do the math on it, and let's see here, it's something like. With a Magus for 4, I mean, it's one of those things where, what are the cards that, are really good for you? And it's,
Tomb.
You want to hit more reanimation.
Grizzlebrand is just the best.
Dark Petition is really good. And in this scenario, that was crafted, you have 2 blue floating. But it's one of those things where you have a 33% chance to hit 1 of 6 cards. So either Grizzlebrand, the 3 graves you have left in the library are 1 Dark Petition in this case. And then the opposite end is just bricking and hitting all mana, mana sources or discard. And you have a 32% chance of hitting 4 bricks. So, odds are pretty good with that, Magus for 4. In this case, with 2 blue for
the odds are 68, which is almost nice.
Almost.
Story of my life, bro.
So,
the 68 is 69. I know you won. So, yeah, that's all I'm here for is to make terrible jokes and bad observations.
Well, it's working.
Anyone else have thoughts on this hand that is an obvious keep?
Let's go.
Taking that as a no.
And fucks.
Hand 1, 2, 3, 4, that was 5. Number 6, Dark Ritual, LED, Dark Ritual, Lotus Petal, Brainstorm, Duress, Bloodstained Mire. And go.
I don't like this hand just because how often have you been I'll keep this hand. I just need to draw, the Entomb plus Shallow Grave or the Burning Wish, and then like hit three garbage cards, brainstorm lock yourself, and then suck and die.
Well, I mean, like, we could rattle off some three card hands that are better than this hand.
Yeah.
God, this hand is tough. It is almost really fucking good. Like, that brainstorm could do some work. Like, you're just going to win or lose off the back of that brainstorm, essentially. If you keep it.
Yeah.
So it better be perfect and skill intensive.
Off a load of fettle in this case.
I mean, I actually really don't hate Off the Lotus Petal in this case, especially because, like, if you see, if you have two dead draws, like, that's so bad.
I think you have to brainstorm Off the Lotus Petal. I don't think you have a choice with this hand.
I totally agree.
If you keep, you're committing to brainstorm Off Petal.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay. Also, the fetch here matters, because having to fetch for a volcanic, oh wait, no, we can get C, I'm dumb. Ignore me, as per usual.
I mean, obviously the correct play here is to land, pedal, fetch for whatever source, so Underground Sea, then go ritual, Lines Eye Diamond, crack Lines Eye Diamond, and then just hope you have a good grand in those top three cards.
Goddamn right.
That's a sweet line.
You could crack for red with the Lines Eye Diamond and see Burning Wish for empty, too.
Yep, it's true. That's exactly what you do.
You have higher odds of getting Burning Wish for empty.
Now, here's the thing. Like, you could. Now, here's the thing. You could keep this hand, be on the draw, and draw, like, Grizzlebrand or Burning Wish, and suddenly that hand... Well, no, because you brainstorm, and then you lose your Burning Wish. Never mind. Ignore me. But
I mean, if you draw Grizzlebrands, that's still fine, right? You can either put it back the brainstorm if you draw an Entomb or something like that. Or Burning Wish is great because then you discard it to Lion's Eye Diamond and reanimate it with Exhum.
Or just draw two more
with the rats, right?
Yeah. So there's some really greedy plays you can do with this hand, but I'm pitching it. Like this, I've seen these hands, and all these hands that I say I would keep are mulligan. I've done the opposite of what I would say I would do. Like, just, once every once in a while just to see what happens. And I've seen this hand. I've kept this hand. This hand has treated me poorly. And I don't like it. That hand gives me, it has bad juju.
I keep it on the draw every time. I think what I said in the article was I might keep it on the play. It depends on my opponent's deck box. Playmat, attire, haircut.
Soul read. We're talking about soul reads.
Yes, bingo. On the play. On the draw, I think I'd keep this because you got a lot of live draws. Off the
soul
top.
Reads. Do you have a soul land?
I mean, are we going to talk about how, like, in my experience, every single guy that plays Pox as their main deck is like, looks like he belongs at like a metal show. Like, he's like the skinny band shirt, long hair, maybe facial hair. Probably pale as hell. Like,
I resemble.
I won't get into that.
Like, no offense.
Said the Pox player at our store always has a sword shirt on.
Yeah, but every time, at least in the Midwest, when I'm at like Star City events when they used to come around here, or Grand Prix, it's like it was always like that same guy that plays the Pox deck like as their main deck, like. Like, I could soon be like, you're playing Pox, and then, what do you know? There it is. So,
Connor and I have a pretty good friend that pretty much only plays Pox anymore in Legacy. Used to only play Blue Control. Very much does not fit that stereotype at all.
Yeah, I'm not saying all the time. But if you see that guy, like, if you see someone dressed like that, they're probably playing Pox. It's the most metal of the decks.
And they're playing, like, beta basics that they opened in a pack.
Dude, yeah. I don't know. We've got a metal band in Denver called Doomblade. Those guys obviously all play Magic too, and they're
bookmarking that on Spotify.
What's that?
Bookmarking that on Spotify.
Yeah, no
first
shit.
First word in this metal band is Doom. I'm in.
All right.
Yeah, and Doomblade 2 to boot, right? So yeah, shout out to those guys. But yeah, so they play like a mix of Belcher and Burn, and I don't know, shit like that.
Belcher, Burn, Death and Taxes are the decks I know that they've played recently.
Oh yeah, Death and Taxes too.
Death and Taxes.
That's great.
Yeah, cool. That's fucking metal, right?
On the subject of metal and stereotyping people, I'd have to tell y'all, since y'all are semi into metal, you know the band Sabaton?
Yes.
Yeah.
So Sabaton does a lot of songs about historical events, especially battles, right? So the guy who did the YouTube show where it was every day, here's what happened today in World War One, has teamed up with them and they're doing a Sabaton history series.
Okay, that's fucking rad.
Where it'll be like, that's great. Here's a song by Sabaton, here is what actually happened in this event. And like Sabaton is involved and like in the room with him. Like, yeah, we read about it in this book and saw this documentary.
I'm in.
I'm with it. Although I will say, because apparently I'm just hating, I'm, you know, being all, you know, stereotypical on people, but like every person I know that like really likes Sabaton also really likes Europa Universalis, that computer game. And I'm also concerned that most of them are, if they're not alt-right, they're like a step away from like making that line to be. Well,
Europa Universalis is a great way to burn like 24 hours in front of your computer.
Oh, I used to play like Mountain Blade all the time. Like I would be like, oh, I want to play Mountain Blade. And then I'd look up and then it would be like 6 a.m. and I'd go have
breakfast. What you're saying is a lot of Sabaton songs, the good guys are all white.
Yeah.
Kind of like this stream.
Yeah. Yeah.
So Kai, are you a bad guy?
Duh. Confirmed bad guy. Sam's confirmed scumbag.
Like, yeah. Confirmed. Yeah. You know, it's scumbag, not cheater. Scumbag.
I guess in that case, that makes me confirmed old guy.
But we know that Kai is super Asian because he has a tattoo and a WRX.
Yeah, these are all factual.
All right, let's go to the next hand.
And on that bombshell.
We've discussed things that aren't hands long enough. All right, we have a polluted delta, an island, a lion's eye diamond, another lion's eye diamond, a cabal ritual, a burning wish, and a grizzle brand. So, Josh, would you like to tell us about how we should definitely be going for Empty the Warrens?
Oh, I wouldn't. What I would like to say is when I first looked at this hand, I was a fucking idiot, and I thought this was an insta ship. For some fucking dumb reason, I was thinking that we really needed a cabal ritual, and Logan enlighten me to a non-idiotic play of just not caring about cabal ritual. So
yeah. So Josh, did you know that in this sideboard for burning wish cards, there are cards that are not empty the warrens.
It's true. It's true. There is Exhum, which is, for what's worth, is what I was thinking of. I just couldn't get around not casting a cabal ritual. It seemed like a fucking waste. So yeah. Anyway, this hand's great. You can make Grizzle Brand turn two. And it's 6 a.m, so it's bad against Force of Will.
For those who are not super familiar, could you explain how you are making Grizzlebrand turn two?
No.
No, fuck those guys.
Read my article, people.
Yeah, it is in the article, which Sam should link in the chat or somewhere that people can get this.
Yeah, I got to go find it again. For like that was time.
So yeah, turn two, you LED, cast Burning Wish, crack LED for black in response, pitching the Cabal Ritual and Grizzlebrand, and you get in tune with your Burning Wish, and then cast Exhum with that 3 black.
That seems like cheating.
It is cheating. That's the great thing about wishes. From outside of the game, any card you want.
Not even and technically, you can wish for more wishes if you put them there, so you know.
It's true. Or if you play by the old rules, where it's just exiled cards, RFG'd cards, just fucking wish for the wish. Don't even go
there. Then we all know Logan's going to be like, hey, I have this sweet card called Pull from Eternity that I really want to make a thing. And guess what? Now we can do even more stuff with it.
Yeah. Shout out to Greg from years ago in his serum powder Pull from Eternity.
Oh, man. So sick.
Oh, I thought that was going to go somewhere different, where it's like Greg had a whole bunch of serum powder, if you know what I mean.
Different stream, buddy.
This is a match.
10 friends after dark.
Yeah. We should definitely do a stream where we all start the night drunk, though. That's
10 Invitational.
I just remembered that I have a bottle of wort over there,
which Sam can't come to like a chump.
Sorry, I'm going to be at the beach with my 92-year-old grandfather.
All right. Well, Zoe says that you should come visit and hang out with Johnny some other time.
Yeah, I'm into that. I'll I'll just randomly hit you up when Spirit's like, hey, get on this flight tomorrow for $4. Like, Josh, yeah. Come.
Yeah, show up whenever you want.
Okay. Yeah, we
don't cast Empty the Warrens with this hand.
Don't.
Okay. Here's the real question with this hand then. So we have two Lion's Eye Diamonds. Obviously, we have to crack one for the Yggdrasil. But do you crack the other one and just go ham with drawing cards? Or do you hold on to it and just play the I'm a regular old reanimator deck, but have Lion's Eye Diamonds and Burning Wish for some reason?
I mean, I think at the point that you've played Lion's Eye Diamond and Burning Wish, it's pretty clear that you're not a regular old reanimator deck.
And furthermore, Logan, like after you've even cast Exhum, you still got a black floating. There's no reason to crack the other one right away.
Well, I mean, I think the reason to crack it is because if you draw seven, now you don't want to crack it.
Well, yeah, that's fine. But you want to save the other one for Magus. Since you have a black floating, there's a good chance you're going to draw into a Dark Ritual and or Cabal Ritual, Lotus Petal, that kind of thing. So
that's true. You are drawing at least 14, probably 21.
Well, no, you're not drawing 21 because you're
not drawing 21, right?
So you don't have haste. But there's a good chance you're drawing 14, and which means there's a good chance you're going to draw Dark Ritual. And since you've got black floating, you should be able to make all the mana you need without cracking the second Lion's Eye Diamond at that point.
This hand is sweet.
I mean, I thought it was shit, but I'm bad at this game. So
you were distracted by the terrible art on some of these cards that Logan put in here.
Yeah, I didn't. Yeah, this is just the thing spat out at me, and I didn't think to fix it because I was, you know,
lazy. Well, I'll tell you, I was considering remaking all the hands, and then I decided not to. So,
well, thanks for at least fixing the Entombs before you posted it.
Yeah, well, I painted all those, and I was like, wow, you cannot read these fucking Entombs at all.
The fucking Entombs I have on Moto, too, the stupid invocation ones, and I get pissed off of myself every time I play.
That's what I play on Moto, and, like, the first time I streamed with Kai, I'm playing, like, three different invocations. He's like, what is that card in our hand? I'm like, it's the cheapest Thoughtseize.
Yeah, had no clue. It turns out Yu-Gi-Oh cards are impossible to read. Who knew?
Yeah, I know, right?
Just a hand of force for a guy where I try to get my deck in as many non-English versions as possible. And, like, at least with, like, a non, you know, with, like, a Japanese Entomb, you know it's still an Entomb. And
yeah, the art and the border, like, you get it, right? Those stupid invocations are awful. God,
yeah, the invocations just don't look good.
I will compliment the other expeditions look excellent. I'm sorry, not the expeditions. The inventions look excellent.
I think they're all fucking trash, man.
I mean, I wouldn't play them because foils are gross, but
I do really like the Kaladesh, those inventions, because that like kind of copper bronze border is really sweet looking for
art. It's really sweet, and some of the art is really nice. I don't like the grindstone, because grindstone on the original art is a picture of a grindstone, and on the reprint art, it's a picture of some gears. Which is not.
I would have been way more into those if they had actually done old border brown, like proper.
Well, isn't there a whole thing that they claim they can't make the old borders anymore because of some printing thing? And it's like, it's 2018. You can fucking print whatever you want. I can order them from China. Why can't you? So actually,
yeah,
so,
I mean, it's, you may even say it's 2019.
Right. So, it's only the first time I've done that.
Jerry and Pat from Leaving a Legacy, they talked to Gavin now and then, and I guess last year or like mid last year or something or other, they were talking to him about like getting suggestions for cards to do old border promos, just like they did with like Noble Hierarch and Sword of Fire and Ice.
Those are such cool promos.
Yeah, they are. They're rad. They're the only foils I like.
I would love, the coolest one would be, have you seen the beta art and text Jace the Mind Sculptors?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, dude.
Those are rad.
I'm going to have to turn my camera off real quick.
We need to monitor like that.
I also want full text basics, which I've been thinking about proxying for my next vintage tournament.
Oh, god damn it, Sam.
Where it's just the entire comp rules about basic lands on a land that says forest at the top. Next hand.
Anything else to say about this hand? Yeah.
Next hand is Preordain, Ponder, Lotus Petal, Entomb, Grizzlebrand, Volcanic Island, Polluted Delta.
I think we should cast Empty the Warrens.
I'm shocked by that.
You have Entomb and cantrips, man. Like, I think you're pretty good here. The hand ain't perfect, but I'm pretty happy with it.
Yeah, I agree. It's pretty hard to pass up Entomb and cantrips.
Yeah, even at the very least, being able to volcanic cantrip and still have a fetch, like, you know, unless you're playing in your local meta where everyone's like, oh, you're the dude that always plays that weird reanimator storm thingamajig or deck that I maybe, you know, misidentify five times. Like, everyone's looking at it going either, okay, you're probably just traditional storm or you're playing like Grixis or something along those lines, right? So it gives you a little bit more flexibility, even in that sense. It's,
right.
It's minor, but I know we were talking about it earlier, like different events, GPs, whatever it is, like people are not going to default to volcanic, you know, cantrip. This guy must be on Bizarro Stormy, right?
Well, we going with the most common. Kai and I were streaming a couple weeks ago, and Kai the next day found the guy who was streaming against us and watched him. Was it seven times he incorrectly guessed what our deck was?
Something like that. Yeah. So,
yeah,
like,
including after taking a screenshot of the deck.
Okay. Yeah. So,
for what it's worth, that
guy, he's a pretty good dude. He's a yeah. really good dude.
I was going to say Michael Clifford. Yeah, he's actually really solid.
I mean to emphasize the point that a lot of times you can win on the back of people don't know what you're doing.
Yeah. Okay. Fair.
But yeah, I keep this hand. I'm quite happy with it for a number of reasons. The Grizzlebrand is obviously a little clunky, right? Because it's not like we can just cantrip into, you know, immediate thing. Like, we certainly can, but like, that's the only sort of clunky thing that I'm like, I'd swap this out for something else. But other than that, like, even then, having Grizzlebrand hand, great. There's this card called Mind's Eye Diamond. It does things.
Or even Thoughtseize.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are a lot of things you can do.
A very large number of live draws.
Yeah.
I would be very tempted. I will again go the hard greed route. I would be very tempted to go Ponder here, entombing on their end step. Like, just only taking the best card off Ponder.
I think it depends on what you get off that Ponder. You know, I mean,
and you don't have to entomb, obviously, but like,
yeah, I was gonna say, what is that best card you're looking for?
Shall
I put you on the spot? But I'm just curious, like,
the ideal would be Volcanic Island, Ponder, take Shallow Grave, Lotus Petal, entomb on their end step, untap, Shallow Grave, you're dead. That would be the best.
I would not play it like that.
Yeah,
I'd definitely hold entomb. In this case, because you might end up wanting to entomb for Pass and Flames. So,
I was actually thinking this looks like an entomb Pass and Flames hand possibility. I don't think I would go that Ponder route. I just wanted to take that greed line one more time.
Sure,
because you could easily go, you know, Volcanic Island Ponder, and then your top three cards are like, you know, Dark Ritual, Pass and Flames, entomb. Or not passive flames, but like Dark Ritual, Lion's Eye Diamond, entomb, and it's like, all right, well, I guess this is now the, you know,
yeah, and you don't play out Lotus Petal, and they think that you're on Rogue Delver.
Yeah, and I mean, even if you don't find another entomb or Shallow Grave or anything, right? Like, if you find a bunch of fast mana, you can entomb for passive flames and recast your cantrips, mm-hmm. and likely win off of that.
We've brought it up a few times, but like the density of action that this deck has, and like action in a bunch of different ways, those value pith lines turn into real action. It's not just like, well, I hope I find a thing. Like, you are very likely to find things and do stuff with pith off of this deck, as opposed to other decks where you have a little bit more fluff when you're at that kind of critical point of needing to do the thing and kill your opponent.
It's kind of similar to when Ant used to have access to Gitaxian Probe with their Pass and Flames lines, right? And be able to dig really deep. Because the density is so high in this deck, you can just cast a few cantrips and almost always find what it is you're looking for.
I'm thinking about the sweet, you know, you look at your Ponder and you hit like a bunch of Dark Rituals or Cabal Rituals, and so you do like the Entomb for Pass and Flames and just go Ritual, Entomb, Pass and Flames, Flashback, Pass and Flames, cast all your rituals, hard cast Grizzlebrand,
just
flex on them real hard.
That's a real line here too. Is yeah, and Tomb for Pass and Flames to hard cast Girls of Rand. Yeah, that's fucking cool.
Don't forget, you always have the option on a hard cast Girls of Rand. You go off pre-combat, and then you reanimate with haste a Grizzlebrand and swing so you can draw seven more.
I've done that one before. It's great.
Well, it's always great if you also tendrils them in your first main phase. So you're like, I'm good. And you're like, reanimate Grizzlebrand, swing seven. Yeah, so basically I'm more about YOLO swagging than I am about winning. That's really the thesis of my night.
You know what? Let me ask you.
Like to talk,
Sam. How often have you played this deck in the last year?
I mean, I played it at GP Seattle to a 1-5 finish.
Okay.
I've played probably 72 of the 75, probably 15-20 times in the last year. Just locals. There are no big events that I can go to. It's 5 hours to SCG Dallas to play in a 4-round side event.
Because the reason why I ask is, like, I found for me, the more that I play this deck, the way more conservative I am. You know, like with Tin Fins, greed all day, because that deck is designed to go off with that. But with this deck, like, a lot of times, you know, you're like a ponder or a brainstorm away from like a line that you weren't even thinking of. And I you know, so like, I feel like, you know, 6 months ago, I'd be with you in slamming and jamming greed. But now after like playing it a lot and at different levels and watching other people do it, like, man, I am just so much more conservative with the greed lines that aren't like blatant. Okay, I can easily get a Grizzlebrand into play this turn.
It occurs to me, actually, I've played it more than that because I bought the whole deck on Modo like 2 months ago. But also, like, a lot of the time, if I'm playing it on Moto, I'm probably drinking. And if I'm playing it at the local, like, a lot of the time, it's like, I don't give a shit. It's $10, it's entertainment, and then I'm going to go have tacos afterwards. So, like, I've played Bizarro in one tournament that mattered, and I had the worst matchups the whole day.
I mean, I was with you. I had bad matchups. Went back, took a shower, beer, and nap, and then we had a break, and then I went on a separate adventure, and then we had a really good dinner, so, you know.
Oh, God, yeah. Well, but, like, so my GP Seattle started with playing against one of the Tusks. He just sat down and was like, oh, Tinfin's guy. I was like, well, that's terrible. And game two, like, I put Grizzlebrand in the play, and he's like, no, dude, go off. Like, I know you didn't get to do it game one, and I'm hoping you don't get to do it game three, so I want you to go off.
But I mean, getting back to the deck and the playstyle, though, I'm totally with Logan. I've got, I don't know, many hundreds of matches at this point with this deck under my belt, and it seems the more I play it, the more conservative I get. But not out of fear, but out of like trying to understand what lines are open to me. And the longer I've played this, and the more I've played it that way, it feels even closer to what DDFT used to be with Top Probe of just trying to see what combinations of cards and things I have available that I could use to combat what my opponent's doing at any point in time. Because there's so many weird lines that you can take with this deck that just aren't common with other decks, and like just things you most people wouldn't usually think about that you have available.
It is very fun to explain to someone who only knows a little bit about the deck when they're like, why did you cast that Ponder instead of that Brainstorm? It's like, oh, well, if I drew this, then this, then this, then I could do this, then this, then this. It's like,
yeah, I mean, like, I've had times where, like, on turn two, I've entombed for Shallow Grave and just passed the turn a few turns after that, and my opponent's just like, what the fuck are you doing, right? It's like, well, I mean, like, I'm just trying to open up another line. Like, yeah, entombing for a reanimation spell seems like the most insane possible thing you could do, but because, like, you can play Pass and Flames and entomb for Pass and Flames, like, there's so many more options available with this deck that you would out of most reanimator type of strategies.
Yeah, when the turn after that, you go LED, crack those, flashback Pass and Flames, like, there's a lot of ridiculous shit you can do.
Exactly, and then, like, it makes sense six turns later, right? But you're like, okay, why the fuck did you entomb for Shallow Grave? That's just, like, the most insane possible fucking thing.
So the puzzle in this deck is so much deeper.
I have, against Pox, responded to him by entombing a Pass and Flames.
Oh yeah, that's a fucking sick play. I love
which besides being fucking sweet, it's also like, I dare you to make me discard.
Yeah, they're scared. They're trying to figure out if they can counter their own thing. To both Logan and Josh's point, like in the same way that some people will occasionally describe, like when they're talking about different storm variants, I keep going back to this, I'm sorry. But like they'll describe Ant as like a control player's storm deck or a control player's combo deck. Like that's, this deck is not OG Tin Fins where you're like slam, jam, like we're fucking, like we're going in, right? Raw, you know, no lube.
Tin Fins, we used to just like try to get a guy in the yard, just keep jamming, you know, 8 to 10 reanimation spells until one of them is stuck, right, as Haymaker. Yeah. That's not how this deck plays.
Yeah, we kept trying to figure out ways, like how do we make it faster? Like what's the optimal balance of lands, fast mana sources, you know, like Lotus Petals, Chromoxes, all that sort of shit. And then it was like, oh, well, hey, should we be playing like Unmasks and stuff like that so we have more self-discard? Like, this is not that deck. And I know, to I think both of your points of, or really everyone's point of this, you know, right now of like the continued, like I'm spending more time with the deck, I'm spending more time with the deck. Like, you have to break those heuristics of other combo decks and certainly other reanimation decks or whatever it is, because it doesn't operate that way. Like, it is that just kind of bastard child of all these other things. Of there isn't like, okay, well, this is the point where I put this card in the graveyard and I do this thing. Like, there isn't a clear like, oh, well, I tutor for this card and I win, right? You know, like we were just saying, really
passing. Because one of the things that it occurs to me is like, we're playing in the standard build, we're playing what, 5 pieces of reanimation in the main?
I think this one only has
Burning Wish, right? So it depends on your build.
Yeah.
Like if I'm not playing Burning Wish, I'll usually be playing 4 Shallow Graves, 1 to 2 Corpse Dance, and 1 to 2 Dark Petition, which can, you know, double as any of those pieces. So
yeah,
I think it's about the same in terms of like 7 to 8. It's like what kind of mana cost do you have to get to your reanimation?
Yeah, I think in my my personal Masterminds Acquisition build, like since I'm running Spellseeker, I'm running, you know, 4 Shallow Grave, like 2 Corpse Dance, and then a reanimate, just purely because I can fetch off Spellseeker.
Uh-huh.
It's just one of those, you know, that particular list, which I like it for my meta, but I don't recommend it for, you know, other people because it's weird and different, you know.
I think you're also the only person that's put in time to really test a Spellseeker build to not just jam Spellseeker in like the Intuition or Dark Petition slot, but build your 75 around that of tutor targets for Spellseeker. I don't think anyone's ever done that outside of you at this point.
Yeah.
Yeah. The list that I'm playing on Modo is a Spellseeker list, and most of the time it's kind of like, oh, Spellseeker. Neat.
Yeah. Well, so I think your list that you have on Modo was the one that I played at Jeremy's last event.
I think so, yeah.
And so I built that one with Spellseeker because, you know, A, I like the card, and B, I like the idea that it can, outside of like the Corpse Dance, it's damn near every instant or sorcery in the 75, you know, that I'm boarding in. And so it was just one of those, you know, so one of the problems that we've had with the deck over the years is sideboarding and finding, you know, enough time to make cuts. Well, Spellseeker to me fixes that, where like it's effectively the second, third, fourth, fifth copy of every instant or sorcery in the deck, you know. So that's why I personally like the card, but I can understand why people aren't too big, you know, on it.
I've streamed a couple times with other people, and it's always the second, third copy thing always comes up, where it's like, no, we're not sideboarding in any sorceries because we're playing Burning Wish. I would rather have 3 copies of this card in Burning Wish than 1 copy in the deck.
Exactly. As a quick aside, any of you that were not paying attention just totally missed a rant. Oh, wait, Papillon. There's a random Papillon. There's a doggo.
Wait. Josh, you need to unmute so that it will focus on you.
Thank you.
oh my god. Stream.
Johnny says sometimes you board in sorceries such as Consigned to Oblivion because you need more balance. That's what Johnny says.
I agree with Johnny.
Yeah. When I'm playing Consigned to Oblivion, I play 2 of them, so I put 1 main, 1 side.
Why wouldn't you just play an Echoing Truth?
Because he found the Chain of Vapor.
Because I copy-pasted the deck list. That's what Xerox Principle means, right?
Yeah, that's why you get to play the deck in Turbo Towns.
That's a whole nother discussion. Let's go to another hand.
It is.
So we're on hand nine now?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yes, 9. We have double entomb, double petal,
keep.
Tarn Terrestrialis. So okay. Kai's keeping. Would you explain why, Kai?
Can we hang on, but Kai, real fast. Connor hasn't spoken in like two hands. I don't know if he's read the article or not. I really want to hear it.
Yeah. I mean, I think a lot about this deck from that aspect of heuristics and just how incredibly difficult it is to develop the ability to go through these thought processes in any sort of meaningfully short amount of time to make good decisions. And so if I were going to take this to a GP anytime soon, I would want to get a game plan together of how to actually think through the lines efficiently. And I think that's really difficult. So if anyone has any thoughts on how they've practiced this deck, I'm very interested, because every time I've put this deck together, goldfished it, whatever, it's just felt overwhelmingly difficult to actually make informed decisions, since there's so many lines that are possible pretty much all the time.
You're too busy playing Oryak Salvagers, dude.
What was that? Sorry?
You're too busy playing Oryak Salvagers.
Connor, I'll tell you, I think I have the problem that my other deck that I play a lot is two-card Mani. And generally, in two-card Mani, if you have one half of any of your three combos, that hand's keepable. And I think that's the problem I have a lot of times with Bazaar. It's like, I have half a combo. That's good.
Mm-hmm. And I think some of it comes down to, you know, shortcuts slash heuristics of what your cards can do. And I hate to keep making the comparison, but Entomb is like Entomb in this deck turns into something kind of similar to Doomsday, of just understanding how the pieces of your deck interact with each other at that point. Of, you know, you used to cast Doomsday, it's like, okay, it's not like memorize a pile and I'm gonna go make this pile. You cast Doomsday and get the five cards that are gonna win the game from there. So it's a similar kind of thing. So like with this hand, you have two Entombs. How do you use those two Entombs to win you the game in that case?
Right. Yeah, so this hand in particular, what is that second Entomb doing for us?
So
I'm getting so two Entombs are
really fucking good. Yeah, exactly. Exactly what Kai said.
Sorry, I missed it, Kai.
I'm getting Pith and Shallow Grave with the two Entombs.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
But to your point, like, it's a very weird thing, because like a lot of people, and I don't blame them one way or the other, if they have any degree of experience or inexperience with any sort of combo decks, reanimation, are looking at this going, well, I have a redundant graveyard / reanimation card, right, in the double Entomb. Like, I need to ship this, right? Like, I can do better. I don't have cantrips, whatever. But to Josh's point, like, it's one of those, each of the cards is a demonic, like, the Entombs are almost demonic tutors for question mark. Mm-hmm. Like, good luck, figure it out. Like, there are, to your point, Connor, like, there isn't this like, oh well, I cast ritual LED, infernal tutor, hold priority, sack my LED, do the thing, right? I'm not just like getting Yawgmoth's Will and like recasting shit and then killing my opponent. It's much more, each individual card is like a thing. And I think to Josh's comparison he's made a few times about DDFT is really great, of their, like, yeah, there were just like basic piles that you would build or whatever it is you would memorize, because it was just the quickest way to victory. But it was also like, okay, like I have all these things, like almost every card was part of the toolbox. You know, Burning Wish and most of our sideboard being like a toolbox sideboard is great. Also super confusing, because you're like, shit, what do I play? Like, what do I board in? What don't I? But it also makes the main deck, because the way that the deck operates, the way it's been built, and sort of like what it's been navigated towards, is very like, you get to just kind of sit there and be like, I'm gonna cast this card, and I'm gonna, as I'm like searching through my deck, be like, oh, I forgot this card did that when I did this thing. So
that's, yeah,
like, so when I saw, like, this, that was the line I took, was like Pith, Shallow Grave. But I am sure there are other people that would be like, oh well, if you did this, or I, you know, I don't know, whatever. Yes. Else,
well, say you're on the draw and they turn one in Sarian Bridge, right? This hand turns into something totally different. And yeah, you Entomb for Burning Wish and Pass in Flames, and then try to find rituals to go empty the Warrens or whatever from there, right? Or something like that, to go sneak under their bridge real fast, right? So it, like, it can turn into a very different kind of thing than like the main plan, and that's yeah, the power of Entomb in this deck. And
I haven't played a deck with Entomb like this before, where it's just, it can do all kinds of different things. It's not just binning a fatty.
Yeah, we're used to Entomb says put target Grizzlebrand into target graveyard.
Yeah, exactly. And in this deck, I mean, shit, I Entomb for lands, I Entomb for rituals.
I Entomb for lands probably more than I Entomb for Grizzlebrands.
Yeah, right? It's Entomb will grab any card out of your deck, and all of them are valid at some point in time.
So
it's probably more accurate to call this deck Entomb Storm, because it's really a Grizzlebrand deck. We're not necessarily Magus in the Mind deck. We're a deck that's trying to abuse Entomb as best as possible within a combo shell. And the fact that, you know, we have a bargain Mind's Desire that you can, you know, cheat into play.
You could play a hand with two Entombs and never put a creature into play and win the game.
Easily. This hand can do that.
Because you can Demonic Tutor for Yawgmoth's Will, it just costs a little more.
Correct. And also, I mean, you know, once again, with this hand, we have land, two Lotus Petals. Like, you hit a Lion's Eye Diamond, you hit, you know, a couple Dark Rituals, and you're off to the races with that, you know, Entomb for Pass and Flames.
It's not an ideal hand for that, but it could easily shape up into it based on your first and second draws.
Yeah.
So, Josh, you've compared the deck to Doomsday twice, and we've had a mini intervention for me being too greedy already. And so, you know Thomas Mason, right?
Yeah, I know Thomas pretty well, and so does Connor.
Oh, yeah.
So, Thomas used to have a thing. You don't show up to your weekly with a combo deck if you haven't goldfished it 100 times.
Yeah, so Thomas... Wait,
there's a second part. Okay. You don't show up to your weekly with Doomsday until you've goldfished it 500 times. And I'm starting to wonder, as y'all correct me on things and as you continue to compare this to Doomsday, if this is on the 500 side rather than the 100 side, that there's just so many lines that you really just need to sit at your desk and goldfish this for an hour a day until you're
tournament. Two things about that. Number one, yes, I think it's closer to the 500 times. Number two, Thomas obviously hasn't played a lot of Doomsday because goldfishing that deck is useless.
It really is. Honestly, I don't like the idea of, like, all right, you know, sit there and like goldfish your combo deck, you know, a bajillion times before you take it to an event. Like, yes, that's good. In the terms of like trying to combo off, but I mean, with this deck, you put the Grizzlebrand into play, you draw 21 cards.
Sometimes, I mean, I don't know if anyone else has done this. I will goldfish and just place restrictions on myself and be like, I'm goldfishing and there's a Poly on the other side.
Yeah, it's a great way to goldfish.
Mm-hmm. When I was first learning to play a lot of decks, and even like every now and then, if I'd pick something else new, I'd go to like, there's obviously a million sites. I'm not plugging anything. They ain't paying us. Fuck them. But plenty of sites where, you know, you can load up a deck list and draw like an opening hand, right? And I would use that. I would do a random number generator to pick stuff off like MTG top eight or whatever. Of like, okay, what deck am I playing against? Draw a random opening hand. That's what I'm testing against, right? And that's a little bit more valuable than, like we're saying, goldfishing, because you're going to be a little bit biased, you know, unconscious bias to be like, oh, this hand just doesn't seem quite good enough, and it's only because you 100% know what you're playing against when you may not in an actual tournament setting or whatever it is. So there is that balance of, like this is not a deck where I'm just going to sit there and goldfish, because there's a lot of things, like Josh was saying, with like, well, you know, I have two Entombs. These can do a lot, but what is my opponent doing, right? Am I Entombing for a Shell Grave, or am I Entombing for a Burning Wish, or am I holding them for, again, whatever else it might be, right?
So, yeah, I mean, they might just counter the first one, right? And then you want to use it for a creature. So, it just changes as the game goes.
Less to your point about your opponent, but to the point about, like, real life. I've occasionally done goldfishing where it'll be like, I'll draw three cards and be like, is this three keepable? If no, like, let's draw one more and just see, is this four? And just, like, at what point you go, okay, let's try this 4 or 5-card hand.
That's cool. I like that idea a lot, actually.
All right.
Never tried that myself. That's a good one.
Well, yeah, a deck like this that mulligans so well, like I said, this is a deck that can kill on 4 cards. So practicing off 7 is almost cheating.
That's a really good point. I've never thought about goldfishing that way. Huh. Interesting.
I'm just thinking about my first actual legacy combo deck was actually DDFT back in ye olde 2012 days. So I goldfished it for a little bit, but my buddy, because we both got into legacy at the same time, he built Rug Delver, and so we would just jam games at his.
What a classic matchup! Holy shit!
Really that was awesome. Back then, that was, in 2012, I don't know what is.
That was Canadian Threshold DDFT.
Yeah, and so like that's just how I learned, was just jam, you know, this is one thing where like goldfishing is good, but if you have people that you sit and play with like over and over and over again, where like we would sit there and play games, and then we'd hit a point with Doomsday, because you know, my friend, he also likes Storm decks, and Kai, you've met, it's my friend Colin, you've met him.
Oh yeah, Colin's great.
So like we would just sit there and like jam these games, and if I got into a scenario, like I'd play it out, and if I messed up, we would rewind and talk through what was going on. And then also we would talk about what was going on in his head, you know, just to try to, you know, figure things out. And so I think probably the other thing is just goldfishing is cool, but if you can get someone to like play with, you know, play against, where you can just sit there and jam out games and then rewind scenarios and replay it with a different mindset, I think that's, you know,
yeah, so that's an interesting point, because I'm a big proponent of when you test, if you make a mistake, you shouldn't fix it, because it will stick in your head more because you've failed rather than going back. That's just the thing I've always done, is like, because if you go like, I do this, oh, actually, I should do this other thing, you're never going to learn from that if you always have the ability to make a take back. So it's interesting that you have basically the exact opposite perspective.
Well, so that depends on how you're testing though, right, Sam? Yeah. Like if you're just like playing a game, I totally agree with you, but like you also have testing sessions sometimes with like say three people. Connor remembers a fellow that used to live in Boulder that we used to play with a lot called, his name is Eric Holmstrom, who recently moved back to Kansas in the States. He and I used to play Doomsday versus whatever control deck. And a lot of times we'd have a third person there with us, either Connor or some other people in Boulder, and just looking at the game state and analyzing like the decisions as they happen. And sometimes like, okay, you make a mistake, well, let's rewind this and talk about that. Why we made the decision, why we might make something else, and then go proceed with what we all agree on is the best play from there, and seeing the deltas of how those scenarios play out at that point in time, right? And actually talking through the analysis.
Well, the tough part about that is you need to get a testing partner or partners who are like, they're willing to print the proxy decks. They know how the decks work. They know how your decks work. And so that is something that it's certainly valuable, but it is, I would imagine for most people, very hard to do well.
It's true. I remember definitely a few times in 2012, 2013, Eric and I being the only people that showed up to our little testing night, and we'd play two games in 4 hours or so, just talking through lines and different options and that kind of stuff. It's slow.
Like, it's, well, it's like that. Ben has joked, he's like, you're the best Magic player around here. You're just really bad at real games. Like, if you want to play a testing game where I am allowed to do, like, be like, oh, let me take something back I did like six actions ago, like, I will give you a really solid game. But if you want to play a real game where we have to play by comp rules, I'm going to do terribly.
But I think it's way different. Like, that's the thing. Like, what are you trying to get out of it? You know, and like, that's the whole reason why I think Logan gave us this exercise. Like, he was like, hey, here's some hands. What would you guys do? And like, why we're talking through this is the whole thing. Like, how long has this stream been going? I'm not going to like, you know, uptime it, but
154 hours in.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, that's the whole reason. Like, all of us have played this deck and variants of it for a fair amount of time. Yet we're all sitting here still being able to say, I agree or disagree for these reasons. And here's all these other things. Like, even as we're talking, like, be it like whoever it is, it's like, well, originally I was thinking this, but now that you guys mentioned that, I could see X, Y, and Z, right? Like,
well, I don't know about you, but I came into this looking to make a stream for other people, and I think I am going to take away from it more than anyone who watches it on the stream.
Yeah, yeah. Like, Sam has finally learned that Empty the Warrens is a card. It's fine. I understand.
I have like, a play set. They're signed.
But like this is the whole point of, like, if you have people that are willing to invest the time in understanding, like, okay, like Sam said, this is how my deck works, this is how your deck works, this is how, like, whatever it is within the field, like, these are all the, like, minute or larger decisions I need to be considering in plays that I'm making, then that's going to make you, regardless if it's Bizarre Stormy or any other deck, like, a better pilot in what you're trying to play as a whole, right? Because you're going to be able to think about things through, like you guys were saying, not just, well, I have these cards. This is what I know about my deck. Like, this is the play I should make. But getting inside the head of your opponent, like, well, I'm probably going to play against this matchup, you know, let's say 40% of the time that I'm at an event. So I need to be thinking about the things they know about my deck or the way that my kind of archetype operates. And how does that change my play? Because if you just go in it and you analyze everything in a vacuum, you're going to do really poorly because you're ignoring the biggest thing about Legacy and just like true eternal magic, which is knowledge of the format, knowledge of everything else happening around you in the room. So,
so that reminds me, Kai, you were at the last awesome event, the last awesome vintage event, which I also attended.
Yeah.
I was in the top four and I was playing against TPS and I had a helm out and I could helm for 9 every turn. Mm-hmm. And I had to weigh the, okay, I know his deck list because we're in top four. He has a Tinkerbot, but he also has Yawgmoth's Will. So what are the odds that I hit a Tinkerbot before he hits a Yawgmoth's Will?
Yeah. It was a very real thing, and it was interesting because like if it had been me in that spot instead of Shane, it would have been a very different situation. Like I, at that time, was not playing Tinkerbot main, right?
If there was no Tinkerbot there, the helm becomes so much worse.
Yeah. Because all you're saying is like, all right, I'm going to give you 9 cards worth of fuel past the turn, right? Like,
are you going to hit Yawgmoth's Will or am I? That's the entire thing.
100%. Or are you going to realize that if you cast Yawgmoth's Will as you cast your first spell, I'm going to respond and do something. That's also hysterical. If you've never done that to someone, I really hope you get to do that soon. It's great. The look on their face is fantastic. But the point is, it's a knowledge game, right?
Okay, so I just wanted to say, apparently my white cat beat out Jacob's black cat. We're still here.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
Also, I have a black cat, but he's old and not friendly.
Oh,
I'm so excited to meet all of your animals.
Yeah, man, we got a bunch. We'll see how many rabbits we have at the time.
I don't want to just focus on Josh's animals. Where's Kale, by the way?
Yeah, what the fuck, Logan?
Kale. I said his name and now he perked his head up. He's been like passed out over in the corner for the last almost 2 hours here.
That's where it's at. I wish I was passed out in the corner.
Oh, and to entice all y'all, by the time Tin Fin Invitational Denver 2019, we'll have another puppy here too. A little Sheltie puppy.
I'm very excited for that.
Yeah, that's gonna be dope.
Kale.
Yeah. Yeah, I would grab him, but he's like 25 pounds now and is very heavy, and I don't want him knocking over all my shit. And plus, if I get all riled up, and then
he's gonna be pissed if you wake him up.
And he just looks so happy.
Sorry, that wasn't the stream. That was my wife. Apologies.
Yeah, fuck her.
Yeah, that's exactly what Sam said. Sam said that. He says, come on over if you didn't hear that.
I don't know what to make of that.
Yeah, you're missing out on Tip Invitational, dude.
Well, again, I have a very good excuse.
Well, hey.
Starting in March, I am traveling at least once a month, mostly twice a month, every month for the rest of the year.
Oh, man, that sounds like my life.
Yeah, except that you're getting paid to do it, whereas I am paying to do it.
Okay, fair point.
Next hand.
Such a slick segue, guys. Well done. Well done.
Next hand. Polluted Delta. Lotus Petal. Preordain. Triple Ponder. Entomb.
All right. Who likes Pondertron?
Does that make 7 mana, too? 7 black? Will that satisfy Cyrus and all his skulls?
I mean, like, you fetch for an island, and as long as they don't stifle you, you're going to get to cast at least a couple spells this game.
Might not do anything, but you'll cast them.
You know, when I saw this hand, I was like, all right, this is a cool one to add in here. And so my thought process is, like, with this hand, we have an Entomb, we got 4 cantrips, we have, like, a land and a Lotus Petal. Like, fuck, there's a good chance we can get to a turn 3 combo. You know, I feel good about it. I feel good and bad at the same time. Cause like, obviously your opponent can go turn 1 chalice. And then you cry forever.
Yeah, that's deck though, dude.
I'm kind of writing all of that off at this point. Of my opponent goes turn one Chalice on game one. Yeah, we're pretty much fucked. This deck is not that great against Chalice. It's better than TES, but not that much.
So I'm really, as much as I do like just like triple ponder preordain is gonna fucking find something. To go back to, like I said, my old reanimator rubric of like, I can name a 4-card hand that's better than this. I can name a 3-card hand that's as good as this. So I'm really strongly inclined to ship this, even though we do have half a combo and 4 attempts to find it.
Well, okay, so let's go off that. So your 3-card hand is Pluto Delta, Lotus Petal, and Tomb. Do you keep that?
Well, okay, so when we're in the situation where we're not imagining a 3-card hand, but having a 3-card hand, Polluted Delta, Lotus Petal, and Tomb is absolutely a keepable 3-card hand.
It is. This hand is so much better than that. Like, you've literally got the best card in your deck in the hand.
It is so much better than that, but we have 6, 5, and 4 between there.
Okay, but so what if your Ponder finds a Brainstorm? Like, your hand is bananas good, right? Like, you've got the best card in your deck in your hand and then Tomb. I don't know how the hell you ship this. Like, it's not a hand that I'm looking for, but the hand is good.
Well, this is, I think one of us referred to this as, I've seen hands like this and they dirtle.
That was Chris. Chris said, this is a dirtling hand if I've ever seen one.
Well, Chris and I both know a thing or two about greed.
I know a thing or two about Entomb. And this hand has it.
Yeah, I mean, I think looking at the article, all three of us said that it's a slow hand, but Entomb and a land, you know, a land where we can fetch a basic so we don't get wastelanded out, like with a bunch of cantrips, like cool. Yeah, it's slow, but if we don't find something, that's just really bad luck. Like, that's, you know.
So with it being a slow hand, again, like, most are we 100% blind thing is real?
I didn't hear you. Sorry, Sam.
So, if we're 100% blind, that's different than even the like reading the playmat thing that we've mentioned earlier.
I don't think we're 100% aligned. Like, you said, you ship this. Like, this hand's slow. I mean, it's not a hand that I'm looking for. But
what is our absolute best turn one here?
Honestly, I want to ponder to find a brainstorm.
Ponder, yeah, ponder.
So you want to ponder to find a brainstorm, then what do you want to do with your brainstorm?
I want to trade some of those cantrips in for other stuff to find it. But if not, like, then you're finding fast mana LEDs or whatever. And
you want to not have half this hand.
What's up?
You want to not have half this hand?
Well, it's fine, but my point is that you can find brainstorm to trade it back. You can tune for flames and assuming you find fast mana like LEDs and things like that. And then cast it all again. And if you don't find your chip by then, well, yeah, luck wasn't on your side that day. Don't buy a lottery ticket.
I feel like the difference is you're not just saying I don't want half of this hand. You're saying I'm exchanging half the hand.
Yeah, yes, yes.
I guess that's true. The half the hand you don't want, in air quotes, is still good if you can't send it back.
Yeah, bingo.
Yeah.
Right?
Not good. It's good enough.
And it's the
difference. In the very first case, you cast all of those things, mm-hmm. don't find shit, then you entomb for Pass in Flames because you found mana by that point and cast them all again.
Yeah.
And if you lose at that point, yeah, okay, that's bad luck. What are you going to do?
This is one of those decks where, like, unlike other combo decks, like, your cantrips have so much more value because they're finding you one of either half of the things that you probably want, assuming it wasn't just some Garbo keep.
For me, I feel like I'm going Delta. I'm probably grabbing an island. Mm-hmm. If I fetch off this. So you ponder. You look at the top three. You know, even if it's bad, I'm probably just keeping the best card out of that top three.
Oh sure, I'm preordaining it away.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'll ponder it. You know, I'll ponder it away again next time. Preordaining it away. Like, especially like if I look at the top three. And it's something like, you know, if there's like a land, essentially I'm looking for a land and then any combo piece. And I'm making sure I'm taking the land and then whatever the next best thing after that is. Because the next turn I can get rid of, you know, whatever's left and try again. You know, so I think that first ponder, like that first ponder doesn't have to hit any, for me, that first ponder just needs to hit me a land.
Yeah,
it's pretty wide open.
That's fair. There's a lot of good draws to that Ponder. That's fair, given that hand. Because, I mean, the hand isn't super strong to begin with. It's just, like, in a long game, it's fine. Obviously, if you, again, like most of these fucking hands, if you run a Chalice of the Void on turn one, you're dead. That's this, right?
It's not even worth considering
this. Yeah, exactly. Who cares?
Actually, you're not completely dead. You can, you know, maybe possibly draw into, you know, Burning Wish. And then Burning Wish for the one meltdown in the deck.
Burning Wish also finds a card called Empty the Warrens.
Oh, wait.
It does what now? Wait, what? Empty the what now?
EMPTY space THE space W A. Yeah.
No. Empty the Pulverize? Is that it?
Empty the Pulverize, yeah. Destroy all artifacts. Storm. Trigger.
Warren, she's Indian, right?
God damn it, Sam.
Semi-topical joke.
Oh, we are running Melt on this list. Jeez, I keep thinking about this in terms of the list that I'm playing.
Yeah,
not what this list actually is.
Yeah, this is me. This is me and my thoughts and everything, because I took it upon myself to write this. So we're playing in my playground.
Yeah, fair enough. Okay, my own commentary. I think Meltdown's fucking trash in this deck, but that's me.
I accept
trash card for trash people.
I reject your reality and replace it with my own.
Yeah, bingo. But,
like, hey, that's another point, though. Like, sideboards, main decks, super flexible. We talked about it earlier. Spellseeker, Intuition, you know, Acquisition, whatever you want to play. There was a point where this deck had, what, two or three Masterminds Acquisitions in it? No Burning Wish. Like, yeah, the deck.
I'd still consider that, too. Like, that's not like we're not playing it because it's bad. It's just because, like, we haven't figured out how to make it work right.
Yeah.
Or maybe it's slightly worse, but there's good cases to be made for all that shit.
As I recall, Mastermind's Acquisition was better in a basically strict blue-black version because it's cheaper than Dark Petition and doesn't require a second color.
Well, I think it was good in like versions running green, you know, just because... you're running Carpet of Flowers and you can just jam a Carpet of Flowers and have a lot of mana where you could just cast Mastermind's Acquisition as the, you know, the wild card for any card in the 75 you haven't drawn yet.
There was also the value of casting Mastermind's Acquisition, having them read it and be like, that says you're fucked.
I'm rolling Chinese, so it's great.
Get wrecked, nerds.
But anyway, so yeah, I think this hand is good because once again, you have your rest card in the deck. You have mana. You have cantrips. That first cantrip, there is the only thing that cantrip for me it needs to find is a land or something mana-y, and damn, if everything in the deck is live.
Which cantrip are you casting first?
Ponder. I'm guessing Ponder because I feel like you go Ponder, you keep whatever the best three are. Odds are I'm not shuffling, so I just want like the best two out of it, which is land plus any other combo piece, land plus anything. Honestly, it doesn't matter what it is. I just need land and something, off of it. Right. And then from there, Preordain gets really good when you're going Ponder, taking the best card. And then Preordain, scrying the worst those two garbage cards to the bottom, and having a clear top of the deck for your third turn, cast the third Ponder. So that's my thought process.
Yep.
Yeah.
So this hand is as good as any for me to bring up something I wanted to ask you all. This is an unpopular play, I think, among this crowd, but I'd love to talk about it just a little bit, and that's just jamming turn one and Tomb blind, just instead of dirtling with Ponders or Preordains or whatever, just jam the Entomb, get a Gristlebrand in the yard, and then if they hit Chalice or whatever, then you're not completely dead. You can still draw the Shallow Grave and do fun stuff. Or they can't drop a land and then brainstorm into a Force of Will to counter your Entomb later, or daze your Entomb. So your Entomb is much more likely to resolve if you just jam it on turn one. I know this is unpopular, but I think in a I think there are metas in which that could be a decent line in a lot of hands.
That's really interesting, Connor, because that's like a lot how Tinfins would play. Mm-hmm. Doing everything you can to get the thing in the yard and then just trying to find the Haymaker reanimation spells from there.
Yeah.
I could see that.
I think you're in this deck. You're entombing a Grizzlebrand and then pondering into the combo. And you could instead ponder into the combo and then entomb Grizzlebrand, and pondering into the combo disguises information and makes their hate weaker, at least initially.
Yeah, I mean, I think both are fair lines to take. Like, if you just want to go all in on the reanimation plan, which, given this particular list, I don't know that I would do, since you're only running four Shallow Graves and no Corpse Dance. I think if you're running one or two Corpse Dance and Dark Petition, that's probably a little more legitimate than this. But it's a worthy line to consider, because going back to 2012, what was it, Silas's quote of his graveyard was an encyclopedia of counter magic. That was because I just kept jamming reanimation spells over and over again until one fucking landed. So, I mean, you can do that. And because there's no death rite anymore, like, your guy, particularly game one, your dude's just going to sit in the yard forever. So you could do that game one.
I don't think that's not the line in this hand because of Lotus Petal, but there are hands where if you cast a cantrip on turn one, you can't cast the Entomb on their turn. And if they do something like Chalice or, you know, various other, or discard, turn one discard against you, here you can protect your Entomb against that by dropping the Lotus Petal. But there are a lot of hands where you can't. If you cantrip turn one, your Entomb is really just sitting there. It's sort of it's just a sitting duck for discard or Chalice.
That's a really good point.
Yeah.
So are we all on Pete so much, hand?
So I just don't think about that.
What was that, Josh?
I said this deck has such a hard time with Chalice. I just say fuck it a lot, so I just don't,
right. think about it.
Sure. Which is why I lose to you a lot.
That's true.
This is an entire school of thought. Is like, if you are really bad to certain decks, do you pack seven sideboard cards? You just say, I'm just not going to get paired against that, and I'm going to worry about my
matchups. And I think that goes back to some of our earlier discussion of, like, are you preparing for a GP or a local meta or something like that? I go into every event I play thinking about a GP type of meta and just trying to learn against bad matchups and stuff like that, even if I know there's going to be a bunch there. So I mean, unless I'm playing against Connor, and I know he's playing fucking Chalice of the Void and Oriok Salvagers.
But like in a GP meta, like, let's say you play all of day one, which is what, nine rounds?
Eight these days, I think, right?
Eight rounds.
What's a GP?
Sorry, if you're playing in an MF because you are a motherfucker.
A GP is an event at a Magic Fest.
So you're at a motherfucker. You're playing Bizarro's Army. Statistically speaking, in day one, if you play all eight rounds, you will see what, 0.8 Chalice decks?
Yeah, fuck it. Like, I don't care that much, right?
Yeah.
I guess that's like, keep looking at a hand and go like, how is this matchup against Merfolk?
Yeah, exactly, right? Like, how is this matchup against Trismie 21? Yeah, so...
is that problem? That deck plays six Gigapede, right?
Even knows the fuck that deck is.
We were talking about attempting to test decks, and we had a testing session before GP Seattle, and it was me and a couple other guys, and this person showed up very late, and we were trying to be nice, and like, they showed up late, so we stayed and waited for them, and they brought two decks, Slivers.
Hey, that deck's better than
books are real.
It's not a deck worth testing against.
It's not today, but that I think it should be a deck worth testing against, honestly.
And Burn. Hold on, I have one thing to say about their burn deck. It played Island of Whack Whack in the 75.
Fuck, I love this person.
Yes.
And I think we played four matches and we're like, all right, we're getting out of here. Because this is not useful.
Yeah.
I mean, to you guys, but like, this is the reason why, like, my sideboards that I build are always built with an expected GP meta. Like, I could be doing way better at locals if I tuned it, but I'm like, fuck that. Like, I'm not here. I don't give a shit about the like $6 to $10 I spent on a weekly in my local, right? Like, if I'm going to a large event, that I actually want to play, then that's what I care about. That's what I'm trying to test for. And another like thing you said, like, that some
people call you a scumbag for doing is show up with a 40 card sideboard, look around, and build your 15 card sideboard right before the thing starts.
Yeah. I mean, you could. I don't know. I'm like piggybacking along what Kai said. I would rather pack a GP sideboard, play against the worst fucking matchups I can, all local events, and try to get better at those and navigating those just to get the percentage points on it. But hope that I don't do it, right? Because like in the good matchups, who fucking cares, right? If it's like a 90-10 matchup, it's not like you need to practice that. You need to practice the closer matchups and the shit matchups.
So I have an example for there's a player who's very good at Infect, and some rando showed up with Infect, and in his four rounds, he played against two people who had Malira in their sideboards.
Fucked up.
Yeah, I'm not building sideboards. Sorry, Josh, go ahead.
Oh, I was being sarcastic. I said this is Legacy. Oh. Malira is everywhere.
Yeah, I'm not building my sideboard to shore up my 20% matchups, right? Like, I would rather to kind of, not to put words in his mouth, but Josh's point, like, I'd rather be like, hey, this is what I would show, the 75 I would show up to a GP or a, like, 5K with, whatever the hell it is, and like, hey, if I run into this matchup round one or two, these are the things that I'm going to have to do to, like, try to cobble together something that makes sense for game two, game three, whatever it is. But realistically, these 15 extra cards that I brought with me are to deal with the other 7, 8, 9 plus rounds, whatever it is that I have to play. So
right. No matter what deck you play, you have to get lucky in a big event. And particularly playing a combo deck like this, you really have to get lucky with your matchups, right?
Well, so I guess we're kind of describing what in Vintage is called the Dredge Gambit, which is if you want to play Vintage and you want to beat Dredge, you need to be packing at least 6, probably 7 or 8 pieces of Dredge hate. But you could also just be like, fuck that. I'm just going to not get paired against Dredge and beat everyone else.
Yeah, bingo. Well, exactly.
Not to cue anyone that's potentially watching this is considering to attend any of the Lone Star Lurgoyce or Romancing the Stones events down in Texas, be it Houston or Austin. However, like if you look at like the meta breakdown, very low Dredge representation. I would imagine, and if you look at the deck list, most people are packing like less than a handful of graveyard-focused hate cards that aren't there to tag survival. They're not there to tag Dredge. They're there to tag survival. So to Sam's point, it's like, well, if I just don't get paired against the deck, then I can free these sideboard slots up to do other things, right? Like in my DPS deck, I was playing like, I think maybe 2 Tormod's Crypts because I was like, I don't know, fuck it. I'm more worried about Paradoxical Outcome and other shit that I need to try to like balance out the matchup.
Shore up your 45-55 matchups more so than your 20-80 matchups.
Yeah. Win your coin flips.
Yeah. Bingo.
I think with Bizarro, that's an interesting question, though, because one card, since we're a Burning Wish deck, at least this build of it, one card can really radically change a percentage against one of those 20% decks. So the question you're asking is it worth that one card? But there are also so few slots that's a pretty valuable. That's a definitely a cost to putting that one card in. That
wide hate,
right?
Yeah, especially if you're playing Burning Wish. Like it's like you might play something that's a little worse, but like it hits every deck in the format because you can Burning Wish.
It's
I feel like Collective Brutality is one of those cards. Sorry, go for it, Josh.
Oh, I was just gonna. So I've cut Collective Brutality at this point. I play Massacre still in my sideboard, but I haven't cast it in months. But that's why, essentially what you just said, right? Of one card can make such a difference in a couple matchups here and there. Like Massacre is such a good card against non-Teague white decks with Hate Bears. Like that card by itself can just win you the match. And it's worth it in case you get those matchups. Like Collective Brutality is kind of, it's so borderline, right? Like it can... Like it's good against Teague, right? And it's good as a discard spell. So like if you're in a meta where you think both are there, it's fine. But if like Teague and things like that aren't around, then you should probably just be running Duress or Therapy even, right? One of the two is a wish target if you're really looking for a discard to be more mana efficient that way.
Mm-hmm. I mean, when we were building the sideboard originally, I was joking that it's a 5-card sideboard with 10 cards of whatever the fuck you want it to be, where you just need 2 Chain of Vapors and 3 Silent Gravestone, and the rest is just whatever cards you have signed or you really like the art of, or you know, whatever, because like it just didn't, you know, none of that really mattered because Chain of Vapor answered damn near everything. And then everyone was playing Surgical Extraction and at the time Deathrite Shaman. So that was 95% of the graveyard hate.
Right, right. Yeah, like as I mentioned in the Discord again the other day, I do think this deck was better positioned when Deathrite Shaman was legal than it is now. Because graveyard hate was so much more concentrated in the type of effect that it was.
Is that specifically because of Silent Gravestone?
Yeah, so Silent Gravestone, like when Deathrite Shaman was legal, most people's graveyard hate suites were four DRS main deck and two, maybe three Surgicals in the sideboard. And there basically wasn't anything else in the metagame at all. So Silent Gravestone answered 98 to 99% of all the graveyard
hate. Well, we also played, so I stepped away, so I apologize if you already made this point, but we also played three or four Collective Brutality, which are really good against Deathrite Shaman while also doing something that is on plan.
Yeah, so we were just talking about sideboard construction. Right? So at the time, it was just that this deck was better positioned in the Deathrite Shaman meta because everything targeted a card in the graveyard. So Silent Gravestone protected you from basically every effect. Like, unless someone was doing something rogue, which, gee, who would do that outside of us playing Magus the Mind, right? But so, like, if they're playing some rogue deck with, like, Rip Helm or something like that, yeah, okay, you're in trouble. But, like, those percent, again, you're playing percentages. Those percentages were so low at the time. So the 98-99 percentile, Silent Gravestone stopped everything you're doing.
I love that that is, like, clearly a card meant to hurt graveyard decks. And the most places I've seen it, it's helping graveyard decks.
Yeah, Dredge and this kind of shit, right? Like,
well, that's Legacy and Vintage is primarily made up of mistakes.
Yeah, basically. Basically. Like Island.
Hand number 11.
Hand number, oh yeah, hands.
Yeah, we have two left.
I'm a bunch of Imperial stats at this point. I kind of forgot what you're doing.
Yeah, I don't know what the alcohol percentage is on this ginger beer, but it gets you there.
High enough.
Well, it's champagne-y, so it'll go to like 15%. Hand number 11. We have Polluted Delta, Double Lotus Petal, Lion's Eye Diamond, Entomb, Brainstorm, Pasted Flames. So we can cast Pasted Flames on turn one.
We can, and cast nothing else.
Nothing else, yes, true.
I'm willing to bet, I haven't read the article, I'm willing to bet that Josh was saying he would keep this hand.
Was he going for Empty the Warrens?
No, I wasn't, but...
No, it has Entomb, and it has Pass and Flames.
Yeah, I said, also it has Entomb, I keep this hand all day long. So. Seriously, those hands fucking gas. Why would you not keep this? This hand's amazing.
Well, talk to us about it, Josh, since you're really into it. What's amazing about this hand?
So, okay. If I may.
We got the throat clear and everything. I love that.
To use the parlance of our times.
This hand has some redundancy in the form of Pass and Flames. We can brainstorm off of a petal to try to find more fast mana or Shallow Grave, which again is the majority of the deck. Sorry, that's Johnny. If Pass and Flames is countered, it's still in the yard to try again a couple turns later. Also, it has Entomb. Seriously, like, this hand has everything going for it. Like, it's got redundancy, it's got cantrips with Brainstorm, it's got Entomb. This hand is really good. Really good hand.
Do you think Entomb for Shallow Grave is a fairly likely play with this hand?
I would say it's possible. With Pass and Flames in hand, that becomes way more likely. So, like, essentially, like, if you find a Ritual of Brainstorm, yeah, Entomb cast Shallow Grave, like, right then. And you just take the Entomb Shallow Grave Pass and Flames line to flash them both back. Right. But it doesn't necessarily have to, right? There's a decent chance off the Brainstorm we find just a bunch of Rituals, and Entomb can find yet another Ritual or Burning Wish or something like that to go just make a natural storm line into Tendrils.
So are you Lotus Petal Brainstorm? Is that your first thing you do out of this hand?
I don't think I do, actually. No? Well, on the play, Well, geez, that's hard. I hadn't really thought that far into it.
I hadn't thought all the way to turn one yet.
No, I had zero.
It's with these like IQ 5000 questions.
I think probably I wait for a draw, no matter what, either on the draw or the play.
I mean, I wrote that if we draw a Dark Ritual, we go, you know, Entombment to Grave into Pass in Flames and still have the Pass in Flames. But like if you draw a land, you can do that on turn two as well and just use LED for the Grave plus Entomb.
Yeah, totally. Totally. Like, that's, I mean, I think like no matter what, either on the draw or the play, I wait for a draw step.
Yeah.
To figure out the exact line I'm taking. Mm-hmm. I don't think there's a not great pressure here to like do some like cast Brainstorm on turn one because this hand is so good. It's because it's got everything in it. So you can just play, if you're on the play, you can play Polluted Delta pass. If you're on the draw, you get a draw step to play Polluted Delta and, or assuming you play Polluted Delta, but to figure out exactly what your line is from there. Because, you know, if they, even if they chalice, you can Entomb in response no matter what in any of these cases. Mm-hmm.
This hand is sweet. I kind of wish I had thought to set all this up in Cockatrice and just be like, let's just play it.
It's a sweet fucking hand. It's got so many possibilities.
Yeah, this hand fucks. That's true.
Yes, it does. This hand is exactly why I like this deck.
Like this is the hand that like this is the hand that just fucking dunks on people. Like that's what this does. Like,
but it does so many different things. Like we could probably. Like, if I had this all set up in Cockatrice, we could probably do an hour on this hand.
Yeah, totally.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Totally, because, like depending on what they do, your hand just starts doing something different, right? Like, it can just take so many different directions. It's a really fucking sweet hand.
I think to the points brought up before, that's why I'm in the same boat. Like, I keep this, but I'm waiting for a draw of I don't want to commit to going down one avenue too quickly because this hand can pivot so quickly in terms of what it does. So, yeah, I totally agree, though.
That was a way better way of putting what I was trying to say, Kai.
Hey, blind squirrel, find a nut, all that.
I think it's more a bunch of Imperials. I don't know how to talk.
How do you think your thinking on this would change if we were playing, and we had considered this, a double Past in Flames list?
Like two Pass in Flames main deck?
Yeah.
Okay, so a couple things. A, I don't think I would ever play two Pass in Flames main deck. I would play...
I own four now, just in case.
What's up? You own four? Well, so I do play... Like, currently on Modo right now, I'm playing one as a Wish target and one main deck. And I think if you're doing that, this hand actually gets way better than two.
Well, go ahead and shoot me that list for sure.
It's on Deckbox.
Hand number 12. No one has it on this hand because it's sweet, but like so much of it depends on things. I kind of would like to go on a deeper dive on this hand in the future. Like maybe, like I said, we'll pull up Cockatrice and just like see what we draw. But yeah, this hand is sweet. We just don't know what it does yet because it does so many things.
Wait, hand 11 or hand 12?
Sorry. This is hand 11. Okay. The next hand will be hand 12.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
Yeah, hand 11 is sweet. And when it popped up, I was like, ooh, all right. This hand is definitely going in. And yeah, it there's just so much you can do with it. And yeah, it's sweet. I love it.
On to hand 12, the final hand. 1, 2, 3, 4. This only has 6 cards in it, Logan.
Yes.
So we decided that the 7 was bad.
This time we mulliganed, and we have a 6-card hand.
And we have Badlands, Bayou, Lotus Petal, Lion's Eye Diamond, Madness of the Mind, Shallow Grave. This seems forced. Constructed.
So actually, literally what happened here was I hit mulligan instead of restart, and it gave me this hand. And I was like, all right.
Well, yeah. we have We have one, two, three. We have Magus for four with blue floating.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly why this hand is a great discussion point.
So pull up that calculator again and tell me what my Magus for four got me.
Gotcha. All right. I did the math on the article, and hopefully I didn't fuck it up. Apologies to actual math nerds if I did. So essentially, what are the hits that are really good here? And so it's the three Shallow Grave, because obviously that gets us another spin of the wheel. Dark Petition, because at this point we'll have Spell Mastery, which will get us another three black, which we can then get Shallow Grave and do the thing again. And then the two Grizzlebrand, because it's Grizzlebrand, and you have a Grizzlebrand in play and can draw 14.
It's hard to lose when you pay zero for Grizzlebrand.
Exactly. So we have six hits, and so when you punch that into the calculator, it gives you roughly a 33% chance to hit at least one of those cards. Like, that's all I was looking for, was I need to hit one of these cards. What are the odds?
You're saying you need to hit one of those six, and you can also, like, potentially draw into, like, you could cast Ritual for free and brainstorm into the thing you want.
Yep, exactly. So the flip side of this hand is, what is the absolute brick of this hand? And that's hitting all mana and discard. And so that ended up being, like, I didn't write down the math. So 13 lands left in the deck.
So you've got 2% of hitting four lands, 32% of hitting all lands, discard and or fast mana is what you've got. 34% brick, right?
The math came up with hitting all bricks, which is every land, every bit of fast mana and discard, as all four cards, that's a 32% chance.
So we are as likely to live the dream as to live the nightmare.
We are 1% more likely to live the dream than we are to absolutely break.
Okay, you got that reversed.
Do I? Because I had like 33 and some odd percentage.
I'm looking at literally what you wrote in the article.
You wrote 33% chance to basically hit the dream, 2%, and then 32% to not live the dream. So 34 is greater than 33.
All lands, discard, and fast mana.
So Kai's really good at math. So listen to him.
We have a 2% chance of hitting four lands and a 32% chance of hitting all lands, discard, and or fast mana.
So that 2% is inside that 32% for the purposes of... do we care?
Okay, so your wording was confusing.
The phrasing suggested that it was an independent.
So we're 33% to do nothing, 33% to win the game, and a third to the middle is, I guess, the part that's really most worth discussing. Because if we can get over 50%, that's a pretty good place to be.
Well, I think inherently, based on those numbers, you do, right? So 33%, you win the game essentially on the spot. We're assuming two Grizzlebrand, one Dark Petition, or three Grave, just win the game on the spot. 33%, 32% effectively probably lose because you're not doing anything afterward.
Cast in Flames, cast for free. We would also have to have a ritual there. So
you need cast mana. So you're at card combination point there. So then you're like 33% to win in the spot, 33% to probably lose in the spot, and 33% essentially to have a decent chance at doing something, right? I mean, you probably do the actual math on that, but...
What does Burning Wish do for us here if we hit a Burning Wish off Magus?
Good question.
It depends on the other three cards.
We
can't cast anything unless the other three cards includes free mana.
Well, it doesn't need to be free mana. It needs to be any mana, right? A non-land mana. So it could be a ritual, could be...
Well, you're casting them for free off Magus, so it's all free mana.
Okay. Fair enough. I just trying to be clear, right?
We're not casting what we're getting with Burning Wish unless we have other mana to do it.
Yes.
Right, because all we have is blue left over.
Right. Yeah. We need some kind of ritual or artifact mana.
This is the kind of hand where you go off and then your opponent on Moto says something where you have to report them.
New Blucker.
Name and shame.
Fucking New Blucker.
This is a hand I rolled the dice.
Yeah. On a mold of six, I would definitely keep this and just hope for the best.
Mold the six, I get a scry. Like, I'm obviously, you know what? I'll roll the, I'll see what happens with 6.5 cards. Like,
is your optimal scry if you are on the draw Grizzlebrand?
No, because you have to shuffle
Shuffle.
No, I'm saying if you are on the draw, you scry Grizzlebrand, you go Badlands, Lotus Petal, Shallow Grave, crack LED in response, and get Grizzlebrand.
Yeah, you were totally right, Sam. Yeah.
Oh.
I shall scry Grizzlebrand at the top. This hand is fucking bananas.
It's amazing, yeah.
I'm good, yeah.
Yeah, this is another hand where we are, what's the word? We have too many choices to adequately discuss this.
I think if what I wrote, I believe, was this hand is significantly better on the draw than on the play, but I would keep it either way.
I'll just read it because I pulled it up and it's not that long. Keep this player draw, although this hand is significantly better on the draw. Our scry will tell us if we want Magister 4 or wait. If we scry to the bottom on the play, I think we just jam it and Magister 4 on turn 1. There are a lot of single cards and card combinations that can just win the game from there or get us to a good spot. It's a risky keep on the play that gets us a lot better on the draw, enabling us to Magister for a higher number.
Yeah, okay. Cool. I'm not so drunk that I disagree with myself.
Especially when I'm writing code. Like, what asshole wrote this? Oh, that was me.
See, that's the beauty of management. You write code and then hire people to maintain it for you.
Yeah, I'm not there yet. Yeah, I would. This is another one. I'd like to take these last two hands and just run some simulations and see where they go.
Yeah, they're sweet hands. And I think you can do the math, like with the deck list or any deck list that we've got with Hypergeometrics. Mathematics and Magus hits.
I don't want to do math.
Well, let's
see. I got into computers so that computers can do math for me.
Okay, so Chris Field / Manatee, I implore you, do the math for us, particularly for Sam, because none of us want to do it.
Yeah. I did the dirty math. I don't want to do any more than that because I will mess something up.
I'm too fucking old. You know
we could also just simulate it like 10 times and be like, that's the plural of anecdote is data.
Yeah, goddamn right. Yeah, I'm a director. That's exactly how my job works.
But, you know, I think at the end of the day, the big heuristic is like, even with a scry, you know, is a Magus for 4 good? And the answer is, in this case, yeah, we have 2 blue floating, you know, we have a third of our chance, you know, a third of the time we're bricking, a third of the time we're winning the game on the spot, and then anything in between then is interesting depending on what combination it is.
The simple math is we're 50-50.
But you also get mana floating, which I think probably skews it in the favor of wanting
to do it. We're over 50-50. Fucking go for it.
Yeah, just do it.
It's Tiffin's life.
Oh, you would take these odds in Vegas every day.
Goddamn right. Fucking burst that goddamn onion.
Shit, I take a lot worse odds.
Your magnesium, your potassium, your folic acid.
I just like the way they taste.
Like America used to.
End street.
Yeah. So I think one thing, since I feel like we're at wrap up point, because we all agree that hand is Magus for 4 is rad. Is that I was thinking about doing this article with the same hands, but it's like, okay, we're now playing against Death and Taxes. It's one, but you know you're playing against Death and Taxes because you play against this guy every week, or you're playing against.
I don't like that exercise. I think like if we're gonna know the opponent, we should play as sideboarded.
Yeah, totally.
Because, like again, if we're talking about at a GP, how many people do you know at the GP?
True. I mean,
oh god, you want to have a whole separate stream too on sideboarding? Fuck you,
yeah.
Sam.
Yeah, we should. We should make at least 80 to 100 hours worth of content on sideboarding.
This could be like the fourth different podcast I've started. Y'all are just gonna fucking destroy my AWS bill.
Yeah, we are.
Have you guys checked the time? Do you know how many hours we're already into 10 friends?
We are 2 hours and 40 minutes.
No,
That's incorrect. We started at 9:31. So
no, I'm looking at the counter on Twitch because it's my account.
Oh, okay. Oh, dude, that's because you started this early.
Oh, 5 minutes. Okay, I'm off by 5 minutes.
Yeah, you fucking are. So eat your damn onions.
I don't have any. I threw them away because it had been a while. Jesus. Now there's no food left in my house and it's 10:30.
I would be curious, though, to kind of see how we can evolve the discussion around this, because I think it applies not, like, obviously we're talking about it in the context of, you know, Bizarro Stormy and all that sort of stuff, but, like, of just, like, the general kind of, like, we're talking about heuristics or just kind of the critical thinking and analysis of your hands and what you do in different situations. Because, obviously, I don't think there are many situations where, even if we all agree and I'm like, oh, I'm keeping this hand, there was even still a little bit of, I don't want to say disagreement, but like difference of an opinion of like, well, what am I doing turn one, right? Like there were very few where we're like, oh yeah, we're all obviously doing X, Y, and Z. So
my big question on this hand is if you have 30 seconds and no access to the internet, do you keep this hand?
Yeah.
Which but a lot of that is just experience.
Yeah, see, but that's why like all this is interesting, right? Like we're all sitting here being able to talk about it for like 10 minutes and digest it instead of being like, okay, shit, I don't have 15 minutes to look at this before my opponent goes judge. I think my opponent died in their seat drawing their opening seven, right? Like,
see, and that's why I think it's really good to have this particular hand on here where it's like, cool, I am for, you know, I have an option where a very blatant, I am making for a very, you know, for a low number, is this good? And so for me, you know, because I've seen, you know, I knew the math already, I knew that that's a snap keep, and you just jam it. Oh, the poor puppy wants outside. All right, hold that thought.
See you, Logan. See you, Kale.
2-2 for 1. Kai, have you met Isamaru yet?
No.
Isamaru is the shop dog at Pat's.
Have I? I don't know.
She's like an almost all white border collie.
Shop dog, Tin Fins Vitational, right here.
Yeah.
He's such a cutie. I want a dog so bad. As soon as I get evicted from this apartment, it's happening.
Totes adorbs.
So kawaii. Super kawaii. Yeah.
So yeah, Bizarro Story is sweet. If we hadn't talked about it for 3 hours, I'd say let's pull up a stream.
On that note, though, like I am totally down. Like I'm not going to volunteer other people's time, but I'm 100% down. Like there may or may not be interest from chat. Like I don't know who's in chat. I'm not looking. I haven't bothered. Erin has stopped commenting a while ago, so I think she did actually unfollow and subscribe and mute us. But like, nobody's I'm 100% down.
Nobody's watching us. Nobody cares.
No, it's literally just us sitting here yelling at each other. But like, I'm 100% down. Like even if it's just for our own benefit or anyone that like eventually is like, I heard about this thing. Someone killed me with it at some random event. What the hell is this deck? To like actually do follow-up streams about sideboarding
games, well, even or whatever, like, it is. You and I really interesting. You and I have hopped on and just played like 4 rounds before on a Monday.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's great, like, and it was just interesting, like, talking through that, even when we were like, all right, well, we spent half the day drinking, let's decide we're going to play Magic, and then are we playing Paradoxical, are we, like, what format are we playing this round? We'll find out. Yeah, but like,
a couple people were like, do you have a recording of the stream? I was like, I was way too fucked up to post the recording of that stream.
but like, it was just interesting to, like, talk through stuff, and, like, both of us at various points were just like, oh, well, what if we did this? And I was like, oh, shit, I didn't even think about that, right? Alcohol may or may not have been a factor, but I'm just saying.
Streaming in general, right? Is particularly when you have somebody that's like not like delayed, stream delayed or anything like that, to be able to kind of interact and see the lines that, if complex decks like this in particular, of lines you would take versus the lines someone else would take, because it's obviously, even just based on this discussion, that's very different.
Yeah, and that's, I've really liked, I've played 2 different times with Kai, and it's just like, I use all of my time because he'll be like, no, do this because that goes this and that goes this. I'm like, I like that. Or sometimes it's like, no, I don't like that. We're not going that way. But seeing that line is worth it.
Yeah. So I get it. Some of you guys, at least on stream sometime with either my show and tell variant or the Force of Will build that I toy with now and then, a Bizarro, because the lines change fucking radically, particularly with the Force of Will variant where you're very blue heavy.
I'd be interested to see your feedback on that stuff. Because I'm not convinced the deck's bad that way, but I don't know if it's good yet. So I'd like to see if I'm just missing stuff. Or
blue black animator plays 4/4 3 days or 3/4 4 days.
Yeah, exactly. So it's kind of similar to that, except we're playing Lion's Eye Diamond too. So, and the deck just gets kind of weird from there.
I love the idea of like reanimate. They daze you, like pay it with LED.
Yeah. So, well, and that's kind of the thing, right? Is like you play a lot more blue to pitch to Force of Will. You're like right now I've been playing 4/4 3 days main deck, but you could easily play Flusterstorm too, if you wanted to. Because the whole premise behind that is you want to protect getting a Grizzlebrand or Magus into play, and you don't need to crack Lion's Eye Diamond almost ever to do that. So protect your Entombs, protect your Entombs, I guess, to go get your creature in play, and then don't worry about it from there. So I'd be very interested to see with some of those other lists, any of your all thoughts on that and how they play out.
Listen, Maniacs have been playing Daze and like Ant, so there's got to be a way to make it work, like Daze Force, make it work in this deck, which has a little bit more flexibility to accommodate that.
Even in like this list that we were talking about tonight, I like the typical Burning Wish list these days, I would say 50-60% of the time I play 2 days over 2 Duress in that list.
Interesting.
Maybe in 3. So like 4 Thoughtseize 3 days or 4 Thoughtseize 1 Duress 2 days, things like that. I think Daze is really, really powerful in this deck, both in terms of protecting your lands from Wasteland, and as well as like protecting from Surgical, things like that.
It also makes Storm for Magus count empty the Warrens or whatever else you're doing. I've seen you make lots of lines where the extra Storm off of Daze made it go, made it actually a line.
That's
cool.
I forget that you watch me play in paper, Connor.
Oh yeah.
Kind of like I see it.
It's like you see how bad at this game I actually am.
No way.
None of you are worse than I am. No one fought.
Yeah, you're right.
Oh, no one fought at all. Well,
I don't know, man. Sam, I cast Sadistic Sacrament against your 2-card Mani thinking that I was going to be like, oh, this does something. I literally sideboarded in because I'm like,
Yeah, and you're like, oh, wait, he's playing 12 cards that are 2-card combos.
Yeah. I rolled the dice. I'm like, I don't know. Hope he doesn't draw this other card. It was great. We're all equally great and equally terrible at Magic, and that's what makes us a fun group.
I'm just glad Joey's not on here because I think literally every time he's watched me play, I've made the worst fucking misplay ever. Hey, not as bad as Logan's in Kansas City, but outside of that.
That was in St. Louis.
St. Louis. Yeah, you're right.
Man, talk about making mistakes that you'll never fucking make again because it burns so bad.
That was so good. It was so good. What was that? 12 fucking turns?
What?
Was that 12 turns?
Fuck, man. It was a long time. We about won.
10 plus, you had to win, then decided to lose instead.
Oh, were you there when I just very cheekily cast that Mindslaver after he played Stony Silence?
Yes, dude. We watched the entire end of your match.
Because I'll just fucking play a Mindslaver. This isn't doing anything with a Stony Silence in play. The guy, like, stared at me. He's like, yeah, that's cool. And, like buddy that was, like, the judge, like, later he's like, dude, like, I thought, like, you knew what you're doing because, like, that was such a mind fuck of a play. And I'm like, no, I was just going to be cheeky. Like, there was no...
Discard this into the royal to hand size.
I had a guy at Eternal Weekend here before last where, both of us had a Nolrod out and he had, like, 3 monk tokens in play. And game 2, he beat me game 1. I play an EE on 0 and he just fucking scooped. I was like, cool. Good game. Yeah. Game 3.
Man, yeah. Fucking bummer, dude.
That was where he got 3 game rule violations in 1 game and didn't lose the match.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks, Judge Staff.
Nice.
Achievement unlocked.
Yeah. There you go.
Oh.
So I think we're done. Does anyone have parting thoughts?
Parting thoughts are I have not been playing this deck recently, for what it's worth.
I also haven't been playing it recently, but that's because I only play in paper. So,
I've been playing neither online too much. I've been playing Bizarro a little bit online here and there, but honestly, for interest's sake, I've been playing a lot of Phoenix in the past couple weeks. Deck is interesting, really cool lines. Those of you who like therapy, it's a really good card in that deck. Enables some really sweet fucking plays. So I think probably all of you like either the Esper or Grixis Phoenix list, Buried Alive list. They're out there. They're pretty fucking cool.
Well, that actually brings up, sorry, you were trying to end this, Sam, but I was going to say that...
No, I have no problem with this going on just for an infinite amount of time.
Josh, you mentioned trying to do a Phoenix transformational board into some sort of weird Tin Fins thing. So, have you thought more about that? Or
So Jay Blinder, I don't know his actual name, so he posted on the source about this a couple weeks ago. He's also the person who innovated and created the Ice Station Zebra list originally that Matt Nass has popularized. So he, on the source, he posted a sideboard with Buried Alive with that. Let me pull that up real fast. 1 second. It's really interesting. Like, I don't know how good it is because the main deck as well as Phoenix use the graveyard.
That's exactly my problem with it is like, what are you beating? Like, they sideboarded you more than Phoenixes.
Yeah, what are you getting out of it? However, I think... hang on. Stall. Okay. So, it's actually a Burning Wish version. So, he's playing, like, 3 Buried Alive, 4 Arclight Phoenix, and Burning Wish for that stuff. So, you still get access to... this is not the blue version. So kind of going back to Pomegranate's lists from 2-3 years ago and Scott Poo's Martian Law list that he plays these days without blue and Faithless Looting instead of that stuff. So you don't have the cantrip density, so your Pass and Flames become a little different in those cases. Actually, well, list he posts doesn't even play Pass and Flames, which is probably a mistake, but you get Tendrils, Empty, Buried Alive, Exhume, Reanimate out of the board, that kind of thing. So, like, even if they surgical your Phoenixes, you've still got ways to protect Grizzlebrand. Well, this isn't a Bizarro list, so not Magus, but things like that.
It almost sounds like your goal is they only have so many surgicals, and they're not going to be playing real graveyard hate.
Yeah. So you fucking fold based on this anyway. Like the glance at the list that Jay Blinder posted. Like, you fold to Leyline, essentially, or Rest in Peace. I mean, he's playing green for Reverent Silence, so I guess you can get around that. But, like, in the big picture, it's very difficult to beat hard graveyard like that. But surgical and things like that, you overload their surgicals so that they can't take all of your threats from there.
Can also just cast Phoenix and attack them with it.
Yeah, totally. Totally. And I mean,
it's like one Phoenix can be enough depending on what they're playing.
3-2 flyer. I heard Delver's Secret's okay. That's a 3-2 flyer.
I mean, is that better than just like playing Mentor on the side like we did with Tin Fins?
So the problem though with Mentor is we don't have Probe or Top anymore. So really hard to go nuts with Mentor. Like, it's a good card. And that's the Phoenix list I've been playing a lot lately is Esper Phoenix with Mentor. Mentor is the non-graveyard dependent threat. Versus Phoenix, which is graveyard dependent. So Mentor is good, but it's like not like it was in the Tin Fin sideboard a couple years ago.
So at GP Louisville, game 2, Joe Lissette blind therapied Mentor out of my hand and then surgical extracted it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean,
like he therapies him like, all right, this is going to be good because he doesn't know I transformed. He's Monastery Mentor. I'm like, what the fuck is that? And he's like, I heard that's the thing now, and I heard that you've been on Tim. It's like,
fucking Joe.
God, he's really good.
So I played Joe once at Star City Denver in 2013. Was the one time I've ever played him. And he called me for slow play after I drew 21, and I had taken like 15 seconds to try to sort my hand and made a judge watch me. And I felt salty since then. I don't actually have a problem with Joe or anything like that. It was just one of those like, come on, dude, give me a break. I guess apparently I should have taken 30 seconds in between draws, right, to go sort my hand, think about it, then draw 7 more to make a game state action or some shit like that. But yeah.
Sign off thoughts. Attempt three.
Eat your damn onions. That's
they're good for you. They're chock full of folic acid.
They goddamn are.
Thank you. Lots of folks talking about it. You want to know what comes from nature? Onions. God put them here for us to eat, and he chocked them full of folic acid and magnesium, and that's real good for your colon. But I like them because they taste good, like America used to. So listen to old Hank Perkin and eat your damn onions. This is my wife.
Goodbye from Houston.
And Denver.
And St. Louis.
From Austin.
Another Denver.
End stream.